Honest.
Well, a nice movement by Walsh to get out of the corner.
Wonderful
move. Parga is advancing, but Walsh has done a very good job of using his superior reach.
Well, Parga's got to keep him in the corner when he gets him there, right?
Yeah,
he's not
exactly
cutting off the ring. I'd like to see him cut off the ring a little bit, keep him in there, but hey.
Referee stopping, giving a little warning there, letting him back into action. I think, both these guys would be well served to go the body a little bit. They're kind of headhunting a little bit, aren't they?
I can relate. Yeah, not a lot of body work. I think they're excited, family and friends here. Hello,
Parga,
Jay
with
Parga.
A nice combination.
Parga landed three crisp shots there.
Yeah, his right hand is really quick and sneaky.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, Antonio Walsh coming right back.
Walsh is really active this round. You see the left hook and then the pivot, and then he throws it again. He's given different angles to Parga. He's really fighting a different fight this time.
Yep.
This round.
This round and last. I agree. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm impressed.
Mm-hmm. This round's hanging in the balance. They need to keep up the activity. You never know what's going to catch the judge's eye. I think it's a superior work rate, though, of Walsh this round. He's really come back strong in the second round.
Yeah, I'm liking Walsh in this round.
He's found a home for that right hand. I'd give the second round to Walsh.
I'm going second round Walsh, which means we got a 1-1 fight going into the third.
Yep.
Just like you'd want it.
What do you tell Parga in the corner this round, JT?
Well, I tell you what, I think cutting the ring off, if you catch a guy in the corner, cut it off. Also, work to the body, right? How many body shots have you seen this fight?
Not very many.
Maybe
I think Parga's landed a couple. Yeah, they're headhunting.
Yeah.
But they're doing a good job, and the crowd is certainly entertained.
Oh, no doubt. This is an entertaining fight. I mean, these guys are already making a convincing case for fight of the night, right?
So explain the 10-point must system to our viewers. Some of them may not know it.
I tell you what, you're going to give one fighter, the winning fighter of the round, 10, right? So it's 10-9. Now, if there's a knockdown, then it's going to be a 10-8. Right, two knockdowns, 10-7. Three knockdowns, assuming there's no three knockdown rule, it would be 10-6. Right, so 10-point must. So one fighter must receive 10 points. Now, however, let's say somebody lost a point for an illegal blow. Then it would be a 9-9, right? So even if you won the round as a 10-9, then you lose a point, 9-9.
We've got this one 19-19, so it really, this fight hangs in the balance,
19-19,
JT.
19-19, as far as I have seen it. Now, again, we're not officially scoring it. We're talking. We got people walking around up here. We got things happening, but
Parga looks like he's been a little more judicious with his approach.
Both fighters.
Good left hand by Parga.
Beautiful.
He's
left
really
hand.
Doing a good job so far about not approaching forward, moving forward, but not with reckless abandon. And he's real. Oh, nice left hook to the body by Parga.
Yep. And that's what we said,
Walsh
right? That's
coming
if we
back.
Were in his corner. That's what we would have told him, right? Work to that body.
Yeah.
The body counts. The body hurts. Mm.
Oh, they're going at it
great
again.
Great fighters here.
Walsh to the body.
I feel like I want to stand up and clap.
I mean, really good action.
Hello.
Good action.
Hello, Antonio Walsh.
Woo.
Antonio Walsh said, say hello to my little friend.
Yeah,
my right hand.
Both doing so well.
This is an exciting fight, man. I don't want to see either kid lose.
No. No, they're really both putting it out
there. See, that's what we talked about when we were talking about their records,
Yeah, you can't always
tell. Somebody's going to get an L on this, but nobody deserves an L.
No.
I mean, this should be a win for both guys.
Yeah.
Exciting, exciting action.
Two winners in here.
Two winners indeed. You were asking me about the 10-point must system, but you yourself, David Hudson, are a phenomenal, phenomenal judge. You've had how many championship fights have you judged? 17?
I've had 16 world title fights.
I always like to give you a little more.
Thanks,
man. I was
going
to give you one extra.
I hope to have more in my career, but you never know.
That's exciting.
Grateful for every opportunity.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Japan,
yeah.
Las Vegas. You were just in Vegas a couple weeks ago, right? Let's go. Hey. We got a stoppage. We got a standing eight count.
Wow.
Now, that could really make a difference, right?
Yeah, back to that's probably going to swing the bout to Walsh. I'm not sure. I'm not really sure of the need for that.
I didn't love it. I didn't love it, if I were just being honest.
Yeah.
I mean, I know it's not really up to us.
Got to give it to Walsh. Walsh won the fight.
Yeah.
So, Walsh should clearly win that fight now as a result of that third round.
I would think so, yeah.
We had the same score.
Yeah. Well, and you hate to see that because a standing eight count is pretty subjective, right?
Honestly, a slightly suspect call by the referee, if I'm being candid.
Say, Even with two pairs of glasses, I think that was an iffy call.
But even so, I don't think it was outcome determinative. I think
he won that round anyway.
Blue Corner won the round.
Yeah, it's going to be a matter of 1 point difference, right? Well, we'll see. That's how we have it scored, but we'll see. We'll see how these officials have it scored. Shout out to our judges ringside. We got Charlotte Price in the building, owner of Grind House Boxing down in Murfreesboro. You're a Murfreesboro guy, right, Hudson?
Yeah, I grew up there.
Born and raised.
Parents still live there. Love them very much. That was a great fight.
Great fight. 16 and 17-year-old junior goes great fight. 125-pound
open division. Fantastic action. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner in the blue corner, Antonio Walsh.
Yeah, the judges got that one right.
That's what we figured, yeah.
So, but it was a competitive fight. It was a good fight. It's really all we could ask for.
Oh, yeah. If you're Parga's corner, if you're Parga's gym, you can't be mad at the kid. You know what I mean? I mean, he really... really fought his heart out. You know, the standing eight was, like we said, a bit iffy, but hey, they're wasting no time. We got our next fighters already in the ring. Let's go.
Yeah, no, I think these are two of our more gifted pugilists this evening. This is going to be a really good one.
76-pound open division semifinal boxing match, ladies and gentlemen. In the red corner, from Arkansas, Markel Acorn! And in the blue corner, from Louisiana, Devin Edwards!
Yeah, big guys. Big guys for 176, huh, Hudson?
Yeah, and I believe the records on these guys are really impressive. Alcorn's 11-1, and
Mike. He's 11-1, you said?
I believe he's 11-1, and Edwards is 10-1. So
oh, wow.
These fighters are used to winning, and it's going to be a very interesting affair. I'd be interested in your opinion on if either one of these young men will be ready for the professional ranks at some point, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's the goal, right? At the end of the day, that's where all these guys are wanting to go to next. And, man, both guys are built for it. I mean, you know, it's like what you look like when you take your shirt off, right?
Oh, God.
Same.
What
same
an embarrassment.
Virtual idea.
Right, oh, southpaw. What's it like facing a southpaw, JT, if you're an orthodox fighter? Does it throw your rhythm off?
That's in the one fight that I had, the guy was a southpaw, and it's, you know, it's important to work to the outside of that jab hand, right, so that cross can come right down the pike. And that's what we're seeing the red corner here, Markel Alcorn. Alcorn is in the red corner. Devin Edwards out of West Monroe Boxing in the blue corner. That's what Markel's going to have to try to do. He's going to have to try to stay. Now, he's kind of switching stances on him. He's moving around. But as you can see right here, if he can get that front lead foot to the outside of Devin Edwards' lead foot, he'll have a home for that right hand coming right down the pike.
Mm-hmm. Boy, Alcorn is really quick. You know, it's really something to see how talented some of these young men are with their speed and dexterity and ability. It's really something to see. Edwards has sort of a strange style, doesn't he?
Yeah, he moves around a lot. He keeps his hands low, kind of glides around the ring. Can't almost tell, is he southpaw, is he orthodox? It's kind of a switch stance fighter, right? Kind of a hitter, but.
He's getting outworked by,
I was gonna
by
say,
Alcorn right now.
Right now, I'd like to see him kind of settle in and actually fight.
Mm-hmm.
Now, to his credit,
Alcorn
this is his
swarms
style,
him.
So.
Now Edwards looks like he's trying to establish a jab. He's got to get some offense going because he's been outworked so far, and you can't win a fight if you don't land a punch, unless I guess you're the great Willie Pep. But other than that, you got to land some punches.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you know, his movement is
good
not to be mistaken for solid activity, right?
Yeah,
he's
no, he's not landing
there,
anything.
He's not landing anything.
No.
certainly and, this first round's going Markell Alcorn's way.
Yeah, and he's showing Alcorn's showing really good discipline. He realizes he's fighting a long, lanky fighter with an unorthodox style, and he's really adjusted himself quite well.
Landed there.
Those nice, quick, straight punches.
I like that three-punch combination because he throws the 1-2 and then he follows it up with another one, and he found a home for that jab on the third shot. A lot of guys are only looking for that 1-2 and looking to adjust. He threw 1-2 and then another one. Certainly the longer fighter, Devin Edwards, longer reach, but
he doesn't really use the reach to his advantage so far, at least, right?
He's not throwing, you know?
Alcorn seems to be able to sort of do what he wants right now.
He's moving, he's dancing, but he's not throwing. And again, I get it. He's feeling him out maybe a little first round. But in these short fights, you don't have rounds you can take off.
No, this is not a 10-12 round fight,
yeah,
right? These are three rounds.
You've got to fight from the very beginning.
You got to get to it. That's a definite round for Alcorn,
yeah,
wouldn't you say?
10-9, Markell Alcorn out of King of Fitness Boxing down in Arkansas.
You know, Arkansas, that's the childhood home of Mike Rogers and the legendary Ray Rogers, the late, great Ray Rogers, just a gem of a human being. And now we're honored to be working this, Sean.
Super honored. Yeah. I was going to say, now the current home of John Calipari, it sounds, huh?
Mm.
John Calipari going over to the Razorbacks.
You think Calipari can do what Nolan Richardson did?
Those are pretty high standards,
title.
Right? Remember those good old Razorback teams with Corliss, Big Nasty, Williamson?
40 minutes of a heck, I guess.
AT double hockey.
Yeah, they
stick.
Won the national championship in 1994, actually beat my alma mater, the Duke University Blue Devils, when Scotty Thurman hit a rainbow three.
I remember that. Boy, that was a fun team. Who was the other guy on that team? It wasn't Stacey Augmon, though. That was UNLV.
UNLV.
Corliss Big Nasty Williamson was the big guy. And then there was one other. They had a great guard, too. I just can't remember. But, yeah, that 40 minutes, hell, that
Lee Mayberry was
that's
on
it.
That team.
Yeah. Hey, now here we go. Now we're getting a little more action out of Devin Edwards. I think his corner got in his ear a little bit.
They needed to. You know, he gave away round one. And I think against somebody as gifted as Markell Alcorn, you can't give away rounds. Boy, that right hand of Alcorn is quick. Really a quick puncher.
I like Alcorn.
Yeah, I do too. He's got good fundamentals.
I was going to say fundamental, traditional fighter.
I think he's got some good pop in that right hand too.
It doesn't come out of his stance at all.
Yeah, his style would translate fairly well, I think, to the professional ranks if that's something that he has aspirations for. But very disciplined, very quick, and he's not afraid to come forward, man.
Well, you know, with Edwards having such a strong record, like you mentioned, being 10-1, and obviously this has been his style, you know, I would assume, you know, throughout those 11 fights, kind of hard to, right, if something's not broke, you don't fix it. Oh, big right hand by Alcorn.
Absolutely.
That found a home. If it's not broke, you don't fix it, right? And maybe after this fight, he may see that it's maybe a little broke, right? Maybe it's time to start planting those feet and fighting out of a traditional stance, moving a little less.
Yeah, I'll be completely honest. I'm shocked he's 10-1 the way he's fighting right now. I don't see it, but maybe there's something I'm missing, but he's just getting outclassed right now.
You know, I don't know if you said it earlier on the broadcast or if it was just you and I talking, but you said, you know, records can be really deceiving, right? Because, you know, who were the 10? You know, who did he fight versus who did Alcorn fight? Oh, another big right hand. Wow, that was a strong pop.
Yeah, really, Alcorn's really found a home. He's really able to fight in different styles, too. You know, he can counterpunch, he can attack, and Edwards really doesn't have an answer to a straight right hand, does he?
And he doesn't, and he's out. Well, there's a little pop back. He landed a little bit of a left there from his backhand.
Edwards is
beginning to
doing a little bit more.
Yeah, he's found a home there for that left hand. That's three left hands landed by Edwards. I don't think it's quite enough.
No.
Not yet, but might boost his confidence. I like Alcorn stays very composed, right? Very, very little movement.
Disciplined, yeah. He's obviously have good coaching.
Yeah, this is an interesting fight. Totally different styles, right? And styles are what makes fights.
Yeah. It's not like the first fight, right?
Yeah, that first fight was exciting. And this is, too. It's just in a different way, right?
I mean,
this is a traditional fighter versus more of a...
Well, I know you as a connoisseur of the sport really appreciate the different styles. And,
big time. There's another left hand. Tell you what, Edwards has had a much better round this round.
Yeah, but, you know, I don't think it's good enough to take the round.
No.
I still think the harder shots were landed by Alcorn, and...
But whereas the
unless
last.
Unless something dramatic happens, I don't see it happening.
Another left hand, though.
Yeah.
Tell you what,
he came back.
To Edwards' credit, I would say, let's say the first round, he lost, 90% to 10%. He only lost that one maybe 60-40.
Yeah,
right?
I'd still give it to Alcorn myself, but yeah. I could see a judge maybe flipping it and going at 10-9 the other way. Back to your comment about records, I've got a funny story for you. I came to know through the legendary Jimmy Adams at the Music City Mix Factory a fighter by the name of Reggie Strickland.
Reggie Strickland.
And if you Google Reggie Strickland, he has more professional losses than any boxer in history. He lost 237 professional fights. But guess what? He went the distance with a lot of great contenders and fighters. And he once told me at a fight in Louisville, Kentucky, it was actually the Mike Tyson-Danny Williams fight in Louisville. We were both there watching it in press row. Reggie somehow got in press row. I'm not sure how he did that. But he told me, he said, look, Hudson, I could make you 20-0.
Yeah,
right? You just match you up somebody. Now, I think that was quite a bit of hyperbole. Well, I don't think anybody can make me 20-0, but that was about 12, 15 years ago, so maybe. But
Maybe. But I see what you mean, right?
Yeah.
Matchmaking is the key to records.
Yep.
And that speaks back to what we were talking with Kid Shaw, Ryan Shaw, earlier, about – guys not ducking an opponent, fighting tough fights.
I really respect Ryan Shaw for fighting Andre Donovan, I believe it was. That was a really good thing for Ryan Shaw to do. And while he didn't win that fight, I think he won from the experience that he'll gain from it.
Career-wise,
he's got the right attitude to bounce back from him. Floyd Mayweather, lost 8 fights as an amateur, right? And then turned pro in, 50-0? He didn't do too badly,
did he?
Didn't
do too bad.
You notice anything that Edwards is doing differently here?
Oh, is that a slip?
Called it a slip, yeah. Again, not nearly as much activity as the first fight. A lot of feints.
Yeah.
And part of that's good defense, but
the young guys
once again,
really went at it in that first
once
fight.
Again, Edwards is allowing Alcorn to kind of take the initiative, and I think
he's kind of waiting, right?
Needs to be more active. And again, the Alcorn lands another straight right hand. He's really done well with that right hand.
Referee, letting them fight their way out. It's great.
Yeah. This referee's done an excellent job.
I'm impressed.
I actually don't know his name, but he's done an excellent job. I think the blue corner knows they're down. They're trying to do something dramatic here.
Well, that's it. You're going to have to throw.
Anytime I'm always reminded, whenever I say a fighter needs something dramatic, I always say Weaver Tate.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember that. In 1979, Big John Tate of Knoxville, Tennessee, the WBA World Heavyweight title, was cruising on his way to an easy title defense. And in the 15th round, Mike Hercules Weaver hits him with one left hook and
wins the fight in the 15th.
Won the fight. 15th round knockout. That was, in 1982, after the unfortunate circumstance of Ray Boom Boom Mancini and Dooku Kim, the sanctioning bodies went from 15 rounds to 12 rounds for fighter safety.
I was just going
to
ask you that, and I should have known that you would know the answer. I didn't want to set you up with a question that you didn't know the answer to. I was going to say, when did they switch from 15
1982,
to
1983.
Because of the Boom Boom Mancini incident, huh?
Yeah. Dooku Kim, I think, was stopped in the 13th or 14th round, and he ended up dying from that. And that's one thing we got the utmost respect for any person that steps in that ring, man, because I hate to exaggerate, but you're kind of putting your life on the line, aren't you?
Well, you absolutely are, right? I mean, it's, they always say you play basketball, you play football, you don't play boxing.
Yeah.
And, great action.
Yeah, I think clearly Alcorn won that fight.
I think it's 30-27.
I would give it 30-27. Edwards had his moments in the second round, as you said. He got a little more active, but the more conventional style, I think, served Alcorn well.
It paid off, yeah. Well, we'll see. And I tell you, if you looked at the fighters, Edwards, really, I mean, he's longer, right? He appears to be almost, more athletic built, but at the end of the day, this isn't a bodybuilding contest, right? It's a boxing match, and Markell Alcorn, hats off. We'll see who the judges give it to, but I got to think it's 3-0.
It should be, I mean. You never know in boxing, as you say.
Yeah, well, that's just
it. And we got to call it like we see it. We see it as a clear victory for Alcorn, but We are unofficial scorers,
very
as
unofficial.
They say.
Very unofficial. We shall see who the trophy goes home with tonight. Got our main man, Mike Rogers, on the call.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the 176-pound open division, the winner, in the red corner, Markel Alcorn.
Good,
yeah.
Good job on the part. It's a good job on the part of the judges. They got that right. Alcorn clearly won that fight. Actually, it'd have been a travesty if they voted for blue. So,
now you've been in this game for so long. I'm sure you have seen some decisions that were just pure robberies, right? Anything stick out to you? Anything where you just say, I mean,
you know, one that I've studied. I was still a kid when this happened, but one of the great robberies of all time was when Tyrone Ty the Butterfly Everett outboxed Alfredo Escalera.
Ty the Butterfly, that's a great nickname.
Yeah, he was a great boxer from Philadelphia. And it was the ironic thing, it was in his hometown. He outboxed
Escalera
and he lost a decision. Harold Letterman, the late great Harold Letterman, HBO's unofficial scorer, told me that was the worst scorecard that he ever saw.
He told you that personally?
Boxing. He did.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, Ty the Butterfly. He was really, really gifted. There's an excellent book actually about his life and career. Unfortunately, he was murdered. As he had a rematch with Escalera. Really sad.
In the red corner from Louisiana, Jose Torres.
Jose Torres in the red corner.
And in the blue corner from Tennessee, Julian Hall. Daniel Bass to the gloving table. Daniel Bass to the gloving table. Devin Edwards to the physicals table. Devin Edwards to the physicals table. Officials table. Devin Edwards to the officials table.
Yeah, this is looking to be another great one. I tell you what, we've had two fun fights. That first fight. Really
first
exciting.
Fight would be, not to steal from Dana White, fight of the night, right?
Yeah,
would
right.
be a $50,000 bonus there, JT.
Hey, did you hear for 300, he's doing a $300,000 bonus.
Oh, man.
Did you hear
that's,
that?
That's awesome.
I'm hoping me and you get to watch the fights together tomorrow, man.
Man, we got to, man.
Yeah,
it's a tradition, man. Some of the
tradition.
best times ever, man.
Ah, you're a good dude, man.
Can we give a shout out to the monster, though?
Yeah.
Monsterwitz. Oh,
hey,
my.
He's watching wherever he is. Best lawyer, bar none, in the 615, right?
Yeah, Daniel Horowitz.
Daniel Horowitz,
one of a kind.
Maybe Monsterwitz will be back in time. He can watch it with us. All right, here we go. Jose Torres in the red corner. Julian Hall out of the Nashville Boxing Academy in the blue corner. Julian Hall coming in at 9-6. Jose Torres at 10-5. So real similar records for these two. Looks to be a slight size advantage for the blue corner.
Yeah, really. He's long and strong.
He's got long arms, man. Look where those gloves are. Those gloves are almost to the bottom of his shorts.
Yeah.
Yeah, that guy's got some range on him. We'll see if he can use it to his advantage. Just waiting on the official start. I think we're good. Timekeeper is ready. Here comes the bell. Red corner. Jose
so we've got Arkansas versus Tennessee again.
Yeah, Arkansas versus Tennessee.
Mike Rogers' home Well, his home's Tennessee now, but boy, Torres is landing some good
shots.
Torres
nice
is in blue corner, correct?
Yeah.
Boy, he's landing some good shots.
Torres is
in red. Yeah, yeah. So
Julian Hall.
Yeah, Julian Hall landed some excellent counter punches there as Torres came in. But Torres is aggressive, but he's eating some leather as he comes in. Julian Hall has found a home for that straight right hand.
Referee giving him a little warning about some elbows on the inside, but rubbing is racing, right? You got to do what you got to do. Blue corner, Julian Hall looking good, looking long, looking lean, looking effective.
Yeah, tight defense.
Oh, nice little left hand, though, sneaks in there from Jose Torres. Now, what's the warning? An elbow?
I didn't quite understand that one myself. Yeah.
Okay. Well, we'll see. See if we can get a read on what's being told by this official. And again, shout out. Great officiating out of this gentleman. His second fight in a row.
Yeah, I like it when the referees stay out of it and let them fight. You know?
Fair. Yeah. It's like an offensive lineman.
Get too interventionist,
gets
on my nerves, man.
It's like a long
fight.
Snapper. You don't want to know your long snapper's name in football, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't want to know your referee was in there.
Well, that's a good fight, though. These are well-matched fighters.
Hall and Torres.
Torres keeps coming forward. He's aggressive. He's got good head movement. But Hall's very effective on the counterpunching, you know?
Yeah. There's a right hand by Hall coming over the top. Jose working his way forward.
Jeez. I mean, there are two fighters in there, ref. Jeez, it keeps more than one fighter.
Interesting.
I don't really get that, but.
Huh. Yeah, speaking to your point, right?
I mean, let him fight.
We've been giving our guy a lot of credit.
Uh-oh. Boy, Torres lands coming clean. In. Yeah, he's coming in. This is a tough round to score. They both had good moments.
Yeah, and Hall's listening.
Now they're opening up,
again.
Though. Boy, Hall's found a home for that left uppercut to the body. Landed three of them. You know, as Torres comes in and leans over, you know, he is vulnerable to that uppercut. And as you know, the uppercut is a devastating punch in boxing if landed effectively. What's it like? Oh, man.
Jose
Hall,
Torres.
Great right hand.
Wow.
Hall has really found a home for that right hand counter.
I tell you what, man, I'm going to let you score this one because I don't know.
I would actually give this round to Hall.
You're going to give it to Hall?
Yeah. He's really
landed. But you wouldn't be mad at somebody for giving it to Torres, right? I mean,
No, I would not. And we can respectfully disagree on a round.
Yeah.
I wouldn't argue too much with you. I'm not in your weight class or fighting prowess, you know.
I shouldn't be in my weight class, you know. a little extra from the holidays, still hanging around in April, you know.
But that was an excellent round.
I think you're right. I think Julian Hall did enough to win that. Looked like the more proficient fighter, but Jose Torres looked good.
Yeah, both fighters looking good. Hall really found a home for that straight right hand. But then he followed it up with some excellent left uppercuts to the body. And that's what I appreciate was the variety of his attacks.
Yeah,
he threw these left uppercuts to the body.
That's something you don't see, right?
No. Too many fighters are headhunters. Body work is really important. You remember that body punch that Mickey Ward hit Arturo Gotti with? And
Arturo Gotti.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, man.
Or how about Bernard Hopkins? Bernard Hopkins' body shot on Oscar De La Hoya.
Who's your favorite fighter of all time, Hudson?
Oh, God, there's several.
It's hard to say. Right?
One of my favorites was Matthew Saad Muhammad.
Matthew Saad Muhammad? Why did former, expect you to say that?
Well, light heavyweight champion of the world, and he was the real Rocky from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He would be on the verge of almost out on his feet against fighters like Yaki Lopez and Von Zell Johnson and others, and he'd come back and win the fight. His recuperative powers were legendary.
Well said. Recuperative powers.
Torres really coming at it. Torres, I think he got a bit of a tongue lashing
in
the corner.
Call in his
He's
corner,
really
yeah.
putting it on this round, isn't he?
That he is.
But Hall is doing a good job with the counterpunching again. Boy, these are two well-conditioned fighters. It's obviously put a lot of time in the gym, JT.
And these guys are guys that, like we said, you know, both of them look like they would transition really well to a pro fight. to a country box type fight.
Oh, yeah, these would be crowd favorites, I think. You know, Torres, now Hall's coming on. You know, Torres has been the aggressor most of the fight. Hall's kind of turning the tables on him, but
this second round is nothing but action, Hudson.
Man, this is a great fight.
Well, hey, one little secret, don't tell anybody, but the ref's letting him fight a little more, right?
No, he's doing a good job staying out of it.
Yeah, we didn't have six interruptions like we did in the first.
Oh, man, Torres, good right hand to the body.
Big old right hook to the body. Oh, nice right hand. Hall rocks him with that right hand.
That was a great fight. Dude, this was a great round.
I'm excited. I tell you what, Mike Rogers knows how to put on some shows, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Because these are some fights.
Yeah, this is excellent show by the Honky Tonk Hitman himself, Michael David Rogers.
Oh, you even know his middle name?
Oh, yeah. Well, it is my first name.
That's fair.
Yeah.
It's a good name. Yeah. David. David versus Goliath. Look at these guys, man.
Oh, man.
No dope.
Just in the pocket, throwing bombs.
No time off, just throwing, fighting in a phone booth.
No fear. Just fighting on adrenaline, fighting with pure aggression. Torres is, I think, turned the tables, but he's
man,
Hall's finding a room with that right hand.
Hall's landed three of those right hands. And each one appears to have more and more impact on Torres.
Yeah.
Nice
Boy, how do you score this round? This is a tough one.
I'm liking Hall in this one.
You know, it is different commentating than judging.
100%. We're not locked in.
Yeah. You realize it's just a different perspective. But, I mean, sometimes it's clear. Like, Alcorn clearly won the last fight. But
yeah. This one's tough.
Look, Torres.
Here comes Torres. Like a bulldog.
Boy, they both want this badly. Putting it all on the line. It's going to go down in the third and final round, probably with the fight hanging in the balance.
Oh baby.
Man.
Let's
amazing.
Go. How about this action, David Hudson?
Wow, it's amazing.
All right.
Give that round to, brother.
Ah.
It's a tough one.
You could have asked me six different times during the round, and I'd have given you six different answers, right?
I think Hall may have come back, man.
I think
Hall rocked
got
him
it.
The
I
last mean, the, minute of the round.
He
really was
big
landing.
Shots.
Big shots, big right hands.
Big bombs.
Consistently.
So right now we got a 2-0 for our guy.
We do,
Hall.
but it's an iffy 2-0, man.
Yeah.
It's like
yeah,
one where.
Had a 2-0 the other way, you'd understand.
We could see this clearly 19-19 instead of 2018. I mean, Torres started really well, but he didn't finish it nearly as well as his opponent. And right now I think Torres needs to really impose his will in this third round. He's got to come forward like he did in the first minute and a half of that last round, but he's got to have a little more consistency.
You know, that's the only problem that I have with the 10-9, you know, the 10-point must system and 10-9 scoring is there could be totally different 10-9s, right?
Exactly.
There could be 10-9 where a fighter just dominated his opponent, and then there could be a 10-9 where you just barely, you had to decide, you had to give it to somebody, so you gave it to a guy. And you say, man, you know, if you had two of those squeaker rounds and then one dominant round, and you lose the fight 2-1, it's a shame.
Yeah, it's a good point.
You
and
know,
there have been a lot of calls through the years to modify the system, but it's really the best system we've got. Boy, Torres is doing it now. He's
look
coming forward.
Look out for your boy, Torres.
Oh, he's
oh man,
really,
I don't know if that was spit or a tooth, but he knocked something out of Hall's mouth.
That was a heck of a right hand, and he's throwing combinations, JT.
And he's not stopping.
Just overwhelming him.
See, this is what I'm talking about. Mm. Like, this round is all Torres all the time.
Yeah.
Red corner, stand up.
Yeah, he's really straight right hand.
Oh, baby.
Hall's showing a great chin because he took a heck of a straight
and
right hand.
Take a step back, huh? Nothing.
No, he's a tough guy. Both these guys, warriors, man, warriors.
Really tough guys.
But Torres is really coming at him. He's landing a lot of shots.
There's that uppercut.
And
left
hook.
Threw a fastball right over the top. That's an exciting fighter right there.
Man,
boy, I can watch this for 10 rounds.
Torres is really coming on. Now it's going to come down to how that second round was scored, I think.
Because this feels
could
like
go
Torres.
Either way.
This feels like definitely Torres.
Torres, he's really dominated this round, to be honest with you.
Yeah, really has him staggered. Mm-hmm. I tell you what, a knockdown would change things, huh?
Yeah, sure would. Oh, wow. Boy,
oh, nice uppercut.
Hall's coming
Let's
back
Let's go,
now.
Hall. I see you.
Man,
blue
these guys.
Corner.
They want their $50,000 bonus, don't they?
Yeah. Man. Yeah. Is Mike Rogers giving out 50 grand for fighting?
No, I don't think he is.
I think. 50,000 Monopoly money.
Yeah. It's a heck of a fight. Torres is really pouring it on. Really nice, varied attack. Coming down to the final bell. This one is really a crowd. This is a crowd-pleasing affair. Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. Standing HAT.
A standing eight.
Torres did it.
He did it.
Wow. Wow. Dominant.
We got Mike Rogers joining the broadcast. Mike, what do you think about this fight?
This is a hell
of an action-packed fight, is what I think.
Yeah, Mike, you've got a great show going on here, buddy.
I really do. This is, hey, I thought the first fight was fight of the night. I tell you what, these boys right here are leaving it all on the line.
Man, that guy has got an incredible defense.
Ooh, nice uppercut.
Oh, Torres.
Big right hand by Torres.
Big right hand.
Left, right,
oh,
left,
man.
Right. These guys have not stopped throwing.
He
lands
man.
Again with a right.
Wow.
Oh,
I thought he won the amateurs.
Wow. Let's go.
Wow. That was a great fight.
Mike, what did you score for?
I've got to give the edge. You know, it may come down to.
Well, that's a 10-8.
That's got to be a 10-8.
That's
so
a 10-8.
That could be 28-28. But if you have to pick a winner, I'd pick Torres. The dominance of that last round, he really imposed his will. And the second round could have gone either way.
Mike,
so
before you got on the broadcast, we had
Red to win
the first two. But it was
but it was close.
It was close.
Second round could go either way.
And then Torres with the knockdown.
I'd give it to Red.
Going to go Torres, huh?
Yeah, I'm going to go Torres.
All right.
I think he earned it.
We'll get that official decision coming up soon.
Man, I tell you what,
big
Hall.
Big third round for him for sure.
Massive third round. And he showed a great – Hall showed great heart, actually, taking that punishment. But, you know, I guess they know how to fight in Arkansas, huh, Mike Rogers?
Yeah, you know, I mean, you fight everybody in Arkansas.
Sue-wee.
Amazing fight.
Hey, this is going to be cool. We're going to get the official decision on the mic and on the headset. Maybe. We'll see what happens. It'll be better on the headset, I think. Shout out to our man, Trevor Wheeler. Production extraordinaire.
Yeah, he does a great job.
Yeah, he's doing it all while text messaging. This guy can do it all, man.
What's the name? Is it Wheeler Productions?
Wheeler Productions. Stand up. ITK Boxing, ITK Productions.
Is it ITK Productions?
ITK Productions.
Okay.
We see you, Trevor. It's too bad we don't have a camera up here. If you saw him.
I know, right?
Handsome boy.
He's so handsome.
Handsome guy as well. Goodness gracious.
I mean, Brad Pitt hadn't got anything on
this
guy.
It's hard for me to concentrate while I'm up here.
Hell,
I'm distracted.
I'll tell you, I'm so distracted I can't even look at him.
Yeah, yeah. Ooh-wee.
I mean.
This man is handsome.
What's the delay here?
You know.
I'm not paying attention.
I blame Mike Rogers.
It is basic addition, I think.
Mike Rogers does a lot of things well, paying attention. Not one of them.
That's true. I have ADHD.
Yeah, he's got all the letters.
I have all the letters.
All right.
I'm ADHD plus.
We're getting close here. Oh. All right, we got a decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, y'all give a big warm applause for that fight. That
yeah!
And the winner.
In the blue corner from Tennessee, Julian Hall.
Wow.
Jesus.
Now that's with the 10-8 round, huh?
How
is that?
Jesus.
If every judge saw the fights the same way, there'd only be one of them.
So
that's, you know, it's all.
No, it's okay. I'm just curious with a 10-8 round. So. Even if he won the first two, that's a draw.
There is no draw in amateur boxing.
So this is good insight.
So here's the thing. So to your point, if the fight goes down to a draw,
uh-huh.
and your three rounds are over, then you have to pick
Okay. Who dominated more of the fight?
Well, no,
and in that case,
reasonable.
Julian Hall won the first round, won the second round.
I bet you that's
did
what
not
it is.
Win the third round. It probably was 28-28, but the judges were like, well, you know, the guy won two out of three rounds.
Hey,
he was more dominant.
And
that's probably why. Now, I didn't score the bout. I can't say. I'm just telling you the rules.
Yeah. I disagree with that. I think Red Corner won that fight.
I'm not judging it. I'm just telling you the rules.
Yeah.
You know, second round was iffy either way. Torres could have won that fight. So that was dubious.
Tough one.
Yeah, and questionable.
Decision.
And questionable. Yeah.
Dubious and questionable.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, here we go. Hey, we got Ashley Adams in the house, guys. Check it out.
Yes.
Manager extraordinaire.
Yes.
Ashley Adams. We've been.
She is the matriarch of the Adams family. Yeah,
that's very true.
Hey, I was just coming to see if you guys wanted drinks. Do y'all want drinks?
Hey, now we're gonna have to talk to you off air here.
Wait, whoa.
We're gonna switch our headsets.
Yeah.
check.
Holy cow.
All right, we're back. You'll never know what we're drinking.
JT on a Red Bull?
I know.
You're not going to know what we're drinking.
JT on a Red Bull kind of scares me.
Let's go.
Let's go.
I mean,
let me say, Mike Rogers, not paying attention. Mike Rogers.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the 139-pound open division, in the red corner, Shemaian Whitfield.
Shemaian Whitfield, huh?
And in the blue corner, from Louisiana, Zaki Shackle.
I am pretty sure I just blistered them.
I was curious, man.
Names. I have no idea.
Can you say that name again?
I wouldn't, and I'm fearful that if
you try it. Hudson, you try it.
Zaki Shackle.
Zaki
Shemarian Whitfield.
Shemarian Whitfield.
139-pound division. Got Tennessee versus Louisiana.
Which one's Louisiana?
The blue corner.
Blue corner.
Mr. Scarkle.
All right.
Scarkle?
I'm going blue and red. I like to keep things simple.
Oh, man.
Red already found a nice home for the right hand.
Yeah. Fighters being a little tentative, respecting each other, but you got to set that jab, get that jab going, and you can't win if you don't throw and land.
Got it. Yep. Got to fight.
Thank you so much.
One thing about Mike Rogers, boy.
What's that?
He could punch.
Thank you.
His right hand was legendary.
Well, I had to be able to punch. If I couldn't punch,
it'd be hard to box. You'd have to have played basketball.
That's exactly right.
No, but that second Jimerson fight, he hit Art Jimerson with the right hand of the body. It's still one of the hardest punches I've ever seen.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
No kidding.
Broke him.
Where was that at?
That was in Nashville, Tennessee. Right across from the juvenile courthouse.
Oh, yeah. Now it's a club, right?
Who did you have in your corner? The great Kevin Rooney.
Kevin Rooney.
Kevin Rooney was in your corner.
Absolutely.
Dude, this is exciting.
Yeah. It was so funny because I came back after the first round. He said, okay, Mike, I want you to throw a 1-3-7-8. And I'm like, I started adding it all up.
Yeah,
I'm like,
the 7-12. Yeah.
So, you want me to hit him with what? The chair? It was more of a ego boost. To have him in a confidence boost.
That's
to have
really
him
cool.
in the corner. And it was really cool to be able to do that.
And you won a belt after that.
Yeah, and the funny – and if you were to ask a person that didn't know anything about boxing, you could say, hey, I got a trivia question for you.
No.
Who is the only two Mikes that Kevin Rooney won a world championship with? And I would be in it. But guess what? It's a trivia question nobody will ever ask.
Yeah.
Hey.
Most people would focus on one Michael Gerard Tyson, the youngest man to win the world heavyweight championship.
What do you think he's going to do with old Jake Paul? What's your prediction?
Now that's a great question. I'd like to know, what do you think about that?
Well, you know, is Mike Tyson going to go after him? I mean, if he lands,
do we know how many rounds? Is it 8 rounds?
It is. I think it is.
Tyson's fight with Roy Jones was 8 rounds.
But it was in a contract that they couldn't knock each other out.
No headshots. Yeah, no headshots.
No, you couldn't knock each other out. I'm going to guess that there's going to be something similar
Why Tyson threw those great body shots against Roy Jones.
Yeah, there was no headshots.
Yeah, and here's one other fact.
Tyson won that fight. They called it a draw, but Tyson won.
And I think that's what's going to happen in this one because it's not a legitimate fight. I think that they're just going to spar each other for a few rounds. I don't think that, you know, Tyson's not going to diminish his image.
I was just going to say, I don't think the world's ready to see Mike Tyson land on his back with Jake Paul standing over him. Hey, Blue finished out really strong there
Blue,
in that first
Blue
round.
Blue really had good jab, good footwork.
Blue corner.
Thought landed the cleaner
Our
shots,
man from
but
Louisiana.
It's close. Mm-hmm. We'll score that 10-9 for Blue.
10-9 for Louisiana. Now, everybody's already tried his name. Let me try his name here. Zyke.
You can't even read.
I'm not a good reader.
Both are ring announcers.
I guess I should mention, by the way, guys, I don't know how to read. So that part's hard.
You must have been born and raised in Tennessee.
Oh,
man.
Oh,
my goodness.
Raised by wolves. Never learned to read.
Like you were raised by bears.
Yeah. All right. Hey, we got some action ready. Second round.
Yes.
Is upon us.
And see, that's why Trevor Wheeler never boxed. He's too pretty.
Yeah, no. Trevor Wheeler, he's a looker. He's a lover, not a fighter.
This is one of the most handsome men you'll ever see in your life. If you don't know Trevor Wheeler, you got to go Google his name
Facebook,
on Instagram, and
Instagram,
tell this man how gorgeous
Snapchat.
He is.
Snapchat.
I swear to God.
Oh, wow.
He should
Blue
be a model.
OnlyFans,
Blue switched to
wherever.
Cell phone,
he
guys.
Should be a model.
If Trevor Wheeler doesn't have an OnlyFans, that is a true miss. The guy could retire by May.
I wouldn't slam an outhouse door that hard.
Hello.
Oh,
nice, nice right hand. Blue corner. Zyke. Charku.
Yeah, he's really done a good job.
Yeah, I'm impressed.
He's controlling the action,
he
which is very
in
important
in
a bout.
That
like
is
this.
A lot of fights.
What's his record?
18-23.
Wow.
For Zyke Charku. And 4-8.
Kind of surprises me. He's got good skill sets.
Here's the thing. In amateur boxing, this is a very important part of – you can't look at records.
Yeah, we were just talking
in
about
amateur,
that.
In amateur boxing, you're not building records. You're building experience.
Well
so
said.
It's not your – so you're not really – you don't care whether you – I mean, you do care, but it's not as important whether you win or lose an amateur bout. It's whether you're getting in there and gaining that experience. That young man out there right now, what did you say his record was?
Record is 18-24.
He wouldn't look that good if he
right.
hadn't had all
right.
those bouts. So,
right.
yeah, he's 18-23, but you don't know who the 23 people are that he's lost to. And, he, as
and
he's
you don't know how many
skills,
robberies.
He's become this type of a boxer.
Yeah. Mike, you don't know how many robberies.
Oh!
Suffered.
Big shot! Big shot by the blue corner fighting out of Louisiana.
So there's
guys,
there's a bad tendency in some parts of amateur boxing to score the fight for the hometown fighter.
Well, oh, that's yeah? in all boxing.
But
what are you talking about?
Really, amateur boxing is plagued. Bad judging has plagued amateur boxing for a long time.
Yeah, that's Ooh. All boxing. I'm gonna challenge you and say that's all boxing.
Back a little backhand action.
Are
there.
You thinking about Tom Gavin, Mike?
Oh my goodness.
Mike
no,
Rogers.
No, I'm thinking about your ex-wife.
Mike Rogers. No. Mike Rogers beat the heck out of Tom Gavin at the Mix Factory and somehow got an L. I was not judging that fight. That was a highway robbery.
That was a pro fight?
You know, we offered him $6,000 to fight me in a rematch, and he would not take it.
Because he knew.
He knew. I was going to bury him.
I have never seen this side of you before.
Oh, you get him going.
Let's
get him going.
Go. Blue corner still looking sharp.
Every fighter thinks they still got one more left in them. It doesn't matter how old they are. I could probably go pull up I could dig up Jake LaMotta, even though he's passed away like 5 years ago, and he'd probably still think he has one more left in him.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just the nature of the beast. You once it's in your blood, it doesn't get out. That's just a fact.
I love it. That's exciting. I love hearing you talk like that, man. That's so true. Ooh, big pop.
I give it to Blue again.
Yeah, Blue again, but that's a better round. For Shamarion.
And let me be clear. A lot of that's delusional, too. A lot of that's delusional. Doesn't mean they do have one more fight. Just makes they always think in their head they're as good as they were in their prime, never having an idea that they need to go hit the heavy bag for about 3 minutes and realize that's not the case.
Yeah, right.
But, Mike, all modesty aside, you were a hell of an amateur fighter. And didn't you face off with bad Chad Broussard back in the day?
I did. I fought a lot of good guys. I mean, but regardless, I mean, it is what it is. You know, I learned from all of it, and I took that with me. Here's the thing. It doesn't matter, you know, if you win national Golden Gloves championships, world championships, whatever else. It's what you learn as you're developing this young, as a boxer develops. These things, these skill sets that you take, you can take it with you into your family, into your life, into your career,
I
and
like
everything.
That.
And it makes you a winner in all those aspects.
You don't hear guys talk about that enough. That's a really great
JT
point.
It is
actually
important. It's
JT actually echoed a similar theme, talking about when he was training, he was a better person.
Absolutely.
The discipline that brought to his life.
You know, better home life, just feel better all around. Well, because when you're doing something that hard, all of a sudden life's problems don't feel as difficult,
absolutely,
right?
And his girlfriend liked him.
Yeah, which that varies by the day.
No, he is way in over his head with this one.
Punching above my weight class.
Oh, my gosh,
I'm a fat boy, you know?
Yes.
You got in a heavy weight class.
Oh, man. My goodness.
Hey.
She's almost as pretty as Trevor Wheeler.
Yeah.
Almost. Almost as pretty. If you know, I'm telling you, y'all need to go to trevorwheeler.com and check him out.
Net.
I mean, you ought to see Trevor in a swimsuit. Man, it is something to behold.
Man, Blue Corner really is
dominant.
Really doing a great job in
and
this
great
fight.
Footwork. Huh?
Yeah,
fast.
Absolutely. He's
I didn't realize that Shamarion Whitfield was out of swift kick. Swift kick MMA and boxing.
Yeah, and this is a semifinal bout, too.
Oh, really?
So, whoever wins this bout will advance to the championship bout tomorrow night.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that, Mike. So, the fights here, like, let's say you win your fight here. Where do you go next?
Detroit, Michigan.
Okay.
For the National Golden Glove next month.
That's the big daddy. Okay.
That's the big daddy. Let me tell you what.
Will you be in Detroit?
I will be in Detroit, Michigan. But let me just tell you, man, it takes a – you fight the best of the best. I don't care what it is. And I'm fixing to throw some smoke out here, guys.
All right, here we go.
I don't care if it's a USA Boxing National Championship. You know what that means? In 10 years, absolutely nothing. Because somebody's going to say, yeah, I was a USA Boxing National Champion. What is that?
Right.
Nobody knows, but I can promise you this. In 25 years, you go, well, I was a National Golden Gloves Champion. Everybody knows what that is. You don't even have to have a little bit of boxing knowledge to know exactly what
Golden
that
Gloves
means.
Golden Gloves is it, right?
I'm a hockey fan, and they're going to know.
Yeah. No, when you say Golden Gloves, man, I mean, that brings the respect. I guess you're
it's
right.
It's a brand. It is the biggest brand in all of amateur boxing.
It is
the biggest brand in all of amateur boxing.
It's the Trevor Wheeler of amateur boxing.
It's the absolute let me tell you what. If the Golden Gloves looked half as pretty as Trevor Wheeler, it would be.
We're going to have to find a new production guy, by the way, tomorrow.
Golden Gloves should have an OnlyFans.
Oh, my God.
And Trevor Wheeler should be the face
He should be the face of it.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, man. Shamarion Whitfield is fighting, I tell you what. I mean, anybody who's training out of swift kick, MMA and boxing down there on Harding Road, Nashville, Tennessee, you're going to be a tough, tough dude. You know that.
That's true.
Is that Bernard's gym?
That's Bernard Robinson.
Oh, yeah. Former kickboxing world champion there.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, Blue Corner won that belt.
Yeah.
What makes you say that?
He controlled the ring, like you said. He landed far more punches, clean, effective punching, dictated
clean,
I think it was
punching.
Absolutely
30-27.
I think even Ray Charles could have made that determination after the first minute. The
yeah,
only thing
Stevie
that could
Wonder.
Have kept Blue Corner from winning that bout is if he gassed out. He didn't give any inclination.
But Tom Gavin got a decision over Mike Rogers. Anything can happen.
Yeah, that's okay. It's okay. You know what? I'm over it. You should be, too.
I am, too.
You know what? Biden got a decision over Trump.
Hey-o.
They're going to a rematch, so
they are.
What happens.
They're going to have a rematch in November, right?
Yeah. Who knows?
Yeah, well, we don't know. That's right.
Let's just see.
You know, one thing Donald Trump did that I think he deserves a lot
of
credit for.
Guys. That's
no, he pardoned. No, seriously, guys. He pardoned Jack Johnson.
Oh,
that should have been
cool.
done 60 years earlier.
That's true.
Hudson, you're so smart, man. You know everything, dude. That's a great little piece of history right there.
Yeah.
He pardoned Jack Johnson.
Yes.
Trevor, do you want me to keep the volume on him or just keep it as is? All right. Great fight.
Yeah. Blue Corner. Should be.
Yeah. Looks like it's
Ladies and gentlemen.
The way of the Blue Corner.
The winner in the 139-pound open division. In the blue corner, Zaki Shako.
Yeah, it was as expected, but great fight. Good work by both gentlemen.
After this next bout, we're going to take a 15-minute intermission. 15-minute intermission after this next bout.
15-minute intermission.
It's going to give everybody time to look up Trevor Wheeler's Trevor social media page.
Hey, you should say that over the mic. Don't say that over the mic. Poor guy. Poor guy. It's already been hammered enough.
Through the mud.
Dragged through the mud. All right, here we go. We got our next combatants making their way to the ring. Looks like Red Corner's already making his climb. Blue Corner, is he on his worthy? I don't see Blue. Oh, there's Blue Corner. Man.
Is this the fifth bout?
This is the fifth bout.
Blue Corner.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the fifth bout, in the 132-pound open division, from Mississippi, in the red corner, Cameron Connor!
Mississippi getting a lot of love.
And in the blue corner, from Tennessee, Daniel!
All right, Daniel Bass, the hometown favorite, fighting out of Music City Boxing. Got Coach Stevie in his
corner.
Got
some nice winning records here, these two fighters. Mr. Connor enters the ring with an 11-4 ledger, and Daniel Bass is 7-3.
7-3. And it looks like he lifted all the weights as well, man. That guy is ripped. Daniel Bass. Got veins popping out of veins.
He weighs 132 pounds, and 32 pounds of it is in his arm.
Yeah, it's all in his biceps, man.
Have you seen either one of these two fellows fight?
I do know Bass. Bass is a pretty good boxer.
Okay. Well, you know, the crowd is really enjoying this show.
Yeah, no, this has been a really, really fun first half of the night.
And one thing Mike Rogers does, he doesn't waste time between bouts.
I love that, man. I got to be honest. When there's so much downtime in between fights, you just lose the momentum, you know?
Both fighters trying to establish a jab.
Both of them looking to control the pace, control the distance.
How important is the jab, Mike?
What are you kidding? Are you kidding me?
Are you kidding him?
Throwing a softball.
Are you kidding the man? Are you kidding the man?
A jab is the key that opens every single door to every single thing a boxer does in the ring. Without a jab, you've got nothing. You've got no keys. You got no way to open any door to do anything in that ring. That jab. That jab is the key. Is the key to everything. Without it, you got nothing. I mean, look at guys like Sonny Liston and Larry Holmes and that could absolutely control you.
Larry Holmes became an all-time great with that left jab.
Absolutely.
One of the best jabs in boxing history.
He would hit guys so many times with that jab, they'd think they were sucking his thumb.
Hey, I mean,
it was the craziest thing.
You know what Larry Holmes also did? He had a lot of heart, man. When Ernie Shavers in that rematch hit him with his right hand
Bass
in the seventh
really
round.
In. He's looking to control the action a little bit faster. I think he's getting a little bit impatient. He doesn't like the weight.
Yeah.
And, he's trying to make something happen, which is what you want to do sometimes.
Cameron Connor out of Pearl Boxing Club down there in the MI Crooked Letter.
There used to be some key boys Pearl. Down there.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Well, Connor. Connor with a good combination there.
The Key Boys, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
I bet somebody watching the broadcast remembers those guys.
Harry
That's cool.
Keys, Donnie Keys, Danny Keys. Yeah, they were good.
Alicia Keys. There's Alicia Keys.
Yeah, but that was their little sister.
Oh, okay.
She was far more successful.
Yeah. That's cool, though, man. I love having both you guys on this broadcast.
Oh, man,
you guys
fine.
No, really, you guys are just a...
you know one thing about Mike Rogers. Mike Rogers is a hell of a singer.
Blame it all on my roots.
Your daughter did a phenomenal job, by the way, with that national anthem.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
She's
13 years old.
Unbelievable, man. The confidence she sings with.
Hey, sing that song I was raised on, Frazier and Holmes.
Oh. Well, we got a show going on.
Daddy tell me, bro.
You guys are gonna start singing during the.
I was growing up.
These guys
I was
are wild,
raised
Trevor.
On Frazier and Holmes.
That's a great, great.
Daddy
album.
Taught me boxing, Mama taught me country songs.
Wow.
And before too long, I was knocking everybody down.
That's a cool song. That's cool, man. This is, I tell you what, if you tuned in, you're getting your $9.99's worth. You have already gotten your $9.99's
worth. You know, two skilled
boxers. Only because
there.
We've given them the directions to Trevor Wheeler's pages. That's the only reason
that's
they've
worth,
got the
that's worth $99.99.
That's worth $99.99.
$99.99. Hey, that was a cool song you just sang, though. You wrote that?
You know,
yes.
Mr. Connor is hard to hit.
Yeah.
That's
some
good defensive skills.
Yeah. Connor's doing just great.
I would actually give that round to the red corner.
Let's give it to Connor.
Mr. Connor.
Let's give it to Connor.
I disagree.
Oh!
Well, you would be wrong, but that's okay. You've been wrong before.
These two gentlemen.
You know what? That's okay.
He thought he could beat me in the game of pool, and I quickly rectified that.
That's true.
David Hudson.
If I spent as many times in the bar room
billiards,
as you, I guess I would know how to play pool, too.
Phenomenon. Billiards phenomenon. When's the last time you shot pool, Hudson?
Last night.
Last time he put his hands in his pocket.
The pocket pool joke. I got you. Da-ding.
He got so mad he took me to some video golf game, beat the tar out of me that I'd never played before.
You know what?
Is it Golden Tee?
Yeah, but he's scared to challenge me in Arkanoid.
So I went and bought the Golden Tee and put it in my theater. So
nice.
Just so I can beat him anytime he comes.
Yeah, I heard
over.
About this theater you got.
Oh,
man,
it's
come
amazing.
Check it out.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Hitman is an amazing human being.
I don't
good
know about
dude.
All
good
that.
Good dude. Yeah, man. Well loved.
I don't
you
know.
Never hear anybody say a bad word about you, man. Until
now.
Until now.
That's because I silenced him. Now, this is where I would say I would tell Bass to close the gap. He needs to close the gap. He needs to use that jab to open the door to set up his combinations. He's letting too much space in between. He's wanting to set the table.
Yeah, he's also getting
but he
hit.
But he doesn't have a fork and spoon.
He's also getting hit.
Well, I know.
Connor is really a talented boxer.
I understand, but at this particular point, he's going to have to do something different.
Yep.
Because the same old same.
Got to switch it up.
Yeah, because he lost the first round.
Exactly.
I see Danny Ziemba's in the house.
Oh, Danny Z, great referee.
Yeah.
Really committed to amateur boxing.
And a great songwriter, too.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I knew he was a musician.
Yeah. We used to do these shows during the CMA Fest week called Indie Outlaw Show, Honky Tonk Hitman's Indie Outlaw Show.
I went to that.
Yeah.
That was fun.
He would always play on it.
We got a bunch of Renaissance people up in
no
here,
kidding,
man.
No kidding.
Multi-talented.
Yeah. Law professor David
you
Hudson.
Talk about talent, though. JT Conway is a ring announcer. Talent.
And a comedian.
Comedian talent. That's a man drips talent.
You know why they laugh at all his jokes? Look how big he is.
Laugh or else.
That's right. Laugh or else.
Laugh or die.
When is your next comedy show, bro?
That's a good
right
question.
Now?
Yeah, well, if you want to hear a joke right now, you know, we'll do it.
Does Bass do anything different, Mike, this round, JT?
No. Not enough.
Well, he's being more aggressive, but it's not effective.
No, it's not effective because he's missing. Yeah. Connor's hard to hit.
He is, but that's why you need to close the gap.
Close the gap.
When you got a guy that is much much faster than you, you need to bury yourself into it.
Yeah,
you need to make it a fight.
Swinging and missing.
He's fighting Red's fight. That's
yeah,
what
well said. Oh, no. Ooh,
that's good right hand. Good right hand.
Home for that right hand. Right on the button, too, huh? That would get Connor's attention.
Good left hook by Connor.
Getting really excited right
how
now.
How would y'all score that round?
Oh, Red.
Gotta go Red.
Gotta go Red.
I think he's up 2-0.
Definitely up 2-0.
But I'm gonna tell you how this normally works.
All right, walk us through it.
Normally, and this is just the psychology of your amateur boxing judges. When there is a close round, and the other boxers already won one, they will tend to even it
interesting. Up. Well
they
said.
Keep the bout
You know, we don't. We're not trained to do that in professional boxing judging. In fact, we're specifically warned against that.
Yeah, you're usually paid and, otherwise. But and, my point being is that's just the psychology because it's a three-round bout, and you don't want to give the bout away.
Yeah, right. Because once it's 2-0, it's over, right?
Exactly.
Now, I see what you mean. Also, there's also kind of that recency bias, right? Like somebody finishes a round strong. You know, even though they may have lost the round, but they finished strong. You see a lot of times the judge give it to a fighter.
You see that in the pros, too.
Yeah, but that's a great.
Look at Ray Leonard versus Hagler. He won. They only won 30 seconds of the last of every round.
But.
And he would, you know, won the majority of the round.
There's a book on that called, and the title of the book is Sorcery in Vegas.
Sorcery in Vegas? About that particular fight?
Yes, sir.
Who wrote that book?
I don't know, but there's several judges I could name in that whole.
Well, in fairness, Hagler didn't do anything the first four rounds.
No, he arguably
gave away those first three or four rounds.
I think he thought in his head that he was going to put the pressure on him and he was going to cave due to his inactivity. I think he hadn't boxed in like 3 years.
Here we go.
Connor landed some.
We got some action right here, folks.
Yeah, they're heating up. And their corners probably told them they need to get more active, you know.
Really, really cool, grateful crowd, too.
Absolutely.
This crowd is into it, man. Yeah, there you go. There's a good angle. Good angle of the crowd there. They're excited, chowing down some of the folks, some of the Texas Troubadour Theater's culinary delights.
Bass keeps his left hand awful low.
Too low for somebody that gets hit that often.
Yeah. He's really got to work on that in the gym, I think.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Unless you're Prince Nassim, you gotta keep your hands up.
There's sometimes maybe a tendency from fighters, you know, the shell, the Philly, you know, the idea of that, but it's not conventional. It's not to be advised.
Yeah, a kid with 10 fights is not going to have mastered that particular style
Correct.
Of boxing.
Correct. Well said, Mike. Yeah, that's a good point. See, now I'd like to see him work that jab, and like you said, he's gotta close the gap.
Mayweather didn't even really box like that as an amateur.
Interesting. Mayweather, 84-8 as an amateur, right?
Yeah. Correct.
I stole that from you guys. You know that.
Absolutely. But that's okay.
I just be listening.
We're going to steal your jokes.
Yeah. You're two smart guys like y'all. Got to steal all you can.
Bass needs to do something.
I would agree. I think Bass is waiting way too long. He's allowing this to happen, in my opinion.
He might not have faced a fighter this quick. The speed of Connor, I think, is troubled in this.
You can see the crowd
fight.
In the background just imploring Daniel Bass to come forward.
Well, they know he's behind.
Yeah, to your point, Mike, you know, when he closes that distance, yeah.
It could be.
Anything could be. Yeah, but like you said, when he cuts that distance out, he's having a lot more success.
Absolutely.
Which is funny because he looks like he should be fighting at range, but he's just not fast as
Connor. Well, you know how to beat speed, don't you? Timing.
Timing
is the only way to
beat speed. Timing beats speed. Oh, nice combination.
Nice.
Connor
flurry.
Is a gangster, man.
He knows how to Sugar Ray Leonard around, doesn't he?
Yes, he does. But he's getting hit a little bit now, too.
Yeah, yep. Connor won that fight. Anything else would be highway robbery.
Yeah, minimum 2-1, probably 3-0. Good fight, though. See, there have been some fun fights. Now, after this, we're going to an intermission, right, Mike?
15-minute intermission.
15 minutes.
So you can go shake the dew off your lily pad.
Oh, hey, I got a lot of dew on my lily pad.
Jesus.
In case you're wondering, that was our friend Trevor Wheeler in the background.
Oh, wow.
He's done with us. He's done with us. He's over us, man.
Oh, man.
He just wishes he had we're anywhere but here. Shake the dew off his lily pad.
He ain't right.
Nothing at all. Oh, boy.
How many punches did he take in his long boxing career?
Seems like one too many. All right.
My dad had a weird name for my defense in boxing. It was called Nun.
Like to catch punches with his chin. Yeah, that's funny. All right.
Oh, yeah, I'd get offended if they missed me. All right,
I'd get offended if they missed me.
That's pretty good.
Silly. All right, we're waiting for the final signal to come in to our man, Mike Rogers. I'm excited for this next fight. This next fight is a kid who I've sparred against, big old boy Daniel Bennett. Shout out to AJ Parker. We see you. Shake the dew off your lily pad.
Oh, my.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
Is the FCC going to come after us?
Yeah. All right. Not sure where this is being broadcast, but.
We have not said a cuss word.
Well, just
one.
Wait. Just wait.
Great job on that.
All right.
Y'all give it up for this fight. Come on now.
Come on now.
After this bout, we're going to take a 15-minute intermission. Then we're going to come back with the big guys. Ooh. Ladies and gentlemen. And the winner in the 132-pound male open division. In the blue corner, Daniel Bass.
Wow. Well, that was crap. That was a crap decision. Those judges ought to be embarrassed.
Wow.
Anybody that knows anything about boxing knows the red corner won that fight. That
what
is
do you guys think about that?
It's embarrassing.
Tell me how you really feel, Hudson.
It's a joke. It's a bad joke.
I told you.
You did. It's a bad joke.
You sure did.
I told you.
You said we don't know what we're looking at here.
We don't
incompetent.
Know what we're looking at here.
Absolutely incompetent.
Golly. Well.
Again, if everybody saw everything the same way, we'd only need one judge. What? But,
yeah, I don't know who saw it that way.
We just had a bunch of incompetents down there.
David Hudson.
You never know. You never know.
It's just absolutely incompetent. There's no other way around it.
I'm not going to say whether I agreed or disagreed with the decision. I think the decision was questionable. But, again, I'm not going to sit here and degrade the judges.
I'm not going to grade them as human beings. They might be fine human beings, but they performed incompetently in judging that bout.
Well, there you go. All right. Well. Hey, you know, that was a iffy one. But
I'm going to take a 15-minute break and go check out Trevor Wheeler's social
media. Let's go!
driveway. My heart was racing as you climbed inside. You slid over a bit close as we drove down to the lake road. Watched the sun fade in that big red sky. I reached under the front seat and said, now here's something special. It's just been waiting for a night like tonight. Oh, it might be a little dust on the bottom, but don't let it fool you about what's inside. It might be a little dust on the bottom, but it's one of those things that gets sweeter with time. You're still with me, and we've made some memories. After all these years, there's one thing I find. Sunset good love, well, it's like a fine wine. It keeps getting better as the days go by. But might be a little dust on the bottom, but don't let it fool you about what's inside. There might be a little dust on the bottom, but it's one of those things that gets sweeter with time. There might be a little dust on the bottom, but don't let it fool you about what's inside. There might be a little dust on the bottom, but it's one of those things it gets sweeter with time. Don't let it fool
jacket if you've lost your hotel key, but you're gonna have to tell me what hotel, and if you're real nice, tell me what room. But just come see me, yellow jacket cowboy hat. Bye.
You can tell your mom I moved to Arkansas. You can tell your dog to bite my leg, or tell your brother Cliff this can tell my lip, he never really liked me anyway. Or tell your Aunt Louise, tell anything you please. A self already knows I'm not okay. Or you can tell my eyes to watch out for my mind. It might be walking out on me today. But don't tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart. I just don't think it understand. And if you tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart, he might blow up and kill this man. Don't tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart, I just don't think.
Officials to the ring. Let's get this party started.
And if you tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart, he mightn't blow up and kill this man. Of a wrestling coming in strong from a satellite send 200 function remote control, big screen TV with stereo, football, baseball, NASCAR too, with picture and a picture and it's all in view. And if it comes on just a little too late with his three CRs, he can get it on tape. He's a high-tech redneck Mad Mary, he's Star Trek, he's a bumpkin, but he's plugged in, he's a high-tech redneck. He's got 20 subwoofers in the bed of his truck, 1,000 watts of power, and he keeps it cranked. He ain't into hip-hop, he ain't into rap. He likes to rattle them speakers with a rolling mill sap. CD, cassette, and digital tape, a CB and radar, and scanning shark tape.
All right, all right, all right. We are back. The 15-minute intermission is over, and we got the big boys in the ring. Now, Hudson, I've sparred with the gentleman coming out of the blue corner, Daniel Bennett.
In the 18 to 40, 203-plus novice division, representing Mississippi in the red corner, Nicholas Parker! And in the blue corner, representing Tennessee, Daniel Bennett!
Let's go. Here we go.
You say you sparred with one of these
guys?
Yeah.
Daniel Bennett and I are friends, and we've sparred several times. I tell you what, the kid hits hard. This will be an exciting, exciting event to watch, man. And I tell you what, it's going to be a difference in power from everything we've seen up till now, because now we got the big boys. Daniel Bennett coming in at 3-3. Nicholas Parker 1-1 out of Hattiesburg. M.I. Crooked letter. We'll see. It says 203-plus. Emphasis on the plus.
M.I. crooked letter, I, crooked letter, I, hump back, I.
Let's go. Here we go.
So would you say that power is Bennett's greatest asset?
I think so, man, because he hits hard. He's working behind his jab. Oh, these guys are throwing right off the bat.
Oh, yeah. They're both looking for the knockout.
I like it.
That's why people love heavyweight boxing, can end with one punch.
Yeah. Oh, and he might right here.
What a shot by Bennett.
Bennett with a nice right hand. Parker fighting back behind his jab effectively.
Parker's trying to get his senses back together. He's trying to get back in the fight. He's trying not to let that shot. Ooh, that jab kind of threw.
Yeah, his jab is powerful,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, got that like Sonny Liston piston type Derrick Henry type shovel run.
Yeah, right, the stiff arm.
Yeah, he stiff arms him.
Yeah, that jab is really finding a home.
God, could you imagine Derrick Henry's jab?
Oh, my gosh.
That'd be quite terrifying, honestly.
He's with the Eagles now, right?
Ravens.
Ravens, that's right.
All the great Titans go to the Ravens. Steve McNair, Derek Mason.
Oh, good point.
They've actually won a Super Bowl. Any team owned by the Adams has never won a championship. Go figure.
Oh. Noted. Oh, nice, man. Nice left hook.
Right now they're just training. They're trading bombs.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
The most recent bomb landed by Daniel Bennett.
And I don't even know how he's still standing.
Two tough, big boys.
I mean, these are thudding shots.
No doubt. And I tell you what, to Parker's credit, a lot of his biggest shots are just that jab. Nice head movement by Daniel Bennett.
He's landing some good shots, too. It's a competitive fight.
You can definitely tell they're novice boxers. You can definitely tell their skill set's under 10 bouts.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, to their point, though, they've got no problem with standing right there in the middle and trading shots. There's no fear there whatsoever.
Throwing combinations a little bit, too.
They are throwing them. They're throwing some combinations. They're doing that. But
the crowd loves it.
The crowd loves this kind of stuff. Yep. Absolutely loves this kind of stuff.
Yeah, well, that's what they're here for, right? See the big boys slug it out, and they're doing just that. Tell you what, this is also the first fight that we're going to see where conditioning is going to come into play, right? Everyone else up until this point has been a smaller guy, probably could go 15 rounds. These guys are going to be gassing quick.
I got news flash for you. Right. Every fight, conditioning comes into play. It doesn't matter if you've had zero fights or whether you've had 100 fights. If you're not in shape, conditioning comes into play. Here's the thing. I'll even go one step further.
All right.
I will take a conditioned, tough fighter over an experienced, out-of-shape fighter all day. Because once I take your gas tank away from you, you are absolutely done. Conditioning will beat experience if experience isn't ready.
Wow. Well said. Well said. What are they throwing? Oh, big left, big right by Daniel Bennett.
Man.
Follows back up with another jab, working some inside dirty boxing. And the red corner, Nicholas Parker, trying to get his wits about him as they begin wrestling a bit, breaking it up.
These guys are hit.
Good right hand.
That's the punch
by
of the night so far. Yeah, and it's got Bennett's feet a little flat right now.
Yes.
He felt that one.
I think his eyes are a little glassy.
Yeah, yeah.
Good jab.
Getting a little head movement back.
I think that, now here's where, here's this is the difference between, this is where you start to see the tide roll a little bit, you know. I think Bennett's gas tank might be a little depleted.
Interesting, yeah. Yeah.
Parker certainly had a better round.
Yeah. And taking that shot the way that he did.
Oh, he just ate a big jab too, Mike.
Oh.
Bennett is taking some pretty serious damage right here in this second round.
Oh, wow.
He's willing to exchange, but he's going to have to keep his guard up. He's going to have to keep his hands a little higher. Yeah.
And he
fires right back. A big right hand by Bennett.
Wow,
this is an excellent fight.
Absolutely. This is fun.
This is what it's all about.
This is what you come here for, right?
This is what it's all about. He's getting worn. He probably is glad that he's getting
worn. Yeah, give me a few minutes.
A little breather.
Talk to me a little bit longer, ref.
Hey, you know, what is it you said again?
Yeah.
I didn't hear you.
I'm sorry, repeat that.
Talk to me a little longer.
10 seconds.
Man.
These guys are giving the crowd what they want.
Absolutely. I think this fight's even, guys.
Even. Absolutely.
I'm going to tell you, this next round is going to be a big one. Now, here's where we were talking earlier about conditioning.
Right.
This is the round where conditioning may come into play. Here's the thing. You know, both these guys have the same amount of hammer in their hands. Absolutely.
Yes,
positively. Both of these guys have good whiskers. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But who is in the shape to go the next round?
And
who
that's
is in
the key. Shape?
Here's the thing. Parker throws straighter punches. So
that could
make a big difference.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
They're both very easy to hit. Mm-hmm. They're both very, very easy to hit. So, Bennett could land one good shot and turn it all the way around.
Bennett's got some pop.
The red corner looks like he's got a little bit more gas. And I think that the straighter punches in the gas tank could absolutely be the difference.
I agree.
Bennett's got a little bit of a hill to climb up right now because of that.
Yeah.
This is the round. This is it. Everything's on the line right here.
Referee inserting himself into the action a bit. Not sure what he's talking about, but again, hey, if I'm a big boy and I'm tired,
I want to hear everything he's got to say.
Please, sir.
Hey, now could you say
me.
That one more time?
Yeah, teach what is me it? Everything. But
do
what
you,
is
do, you
going
do this on? In sign language? Huh? Wait, come on, one more time. What? I didn't hear. I don't hear very well. Say it.
What are we doing though? I'm just curious what the heck that was about.
I
was,
don't know.
Well, that was weird, right?
It was very weird.
I like it when referees sort of stay out of it.
Yeah.
Let them
fight. Oh, nice right hand by Daniel Bennett.
With that
Daniel
shot.
Bennett!
What an incredible punch. He doesn't know where he's on.
They're calling it a slip. I'm joking. They're not.
That was a bomb.
That was a bumble.
This referee is, I'm sorry. Yeah. Arthur
what
Scott,
is he doing?
Arthur Scott is a great referee.
Talking
but,
a little
but
too much right now, right?
Talking too much.
Talking too much, giving
gave
too much
Parker
time.
Some much needed rest.
Much
time.
Needed rest. Much needed rest. These guys. This is like a Rocky movie.
This is great. Hey,
Parker's going to have to land back.
Parker's
big time.
Coming in. Parker's coming in.
Parker.
Moving.
Oh, Parker big catches shot. Another left hook.
Oh, wow. What heart.
What an incredible
this
both
is these fun. Have got a warrior's heart. Man.
This is fun. This is fun.
Where legends are made
this
right here.
This is fun. Oh.
In Nashville, Tennessee at the Troubadour.
At the Mid-South Golden Glove.
The 90th annual.
90th annual. Tell you what, these boys are laying it all out there for us.
My goodness, that was a banging shot. Does Parker have anything left in him?
Yeah, because he can land himself. These boys both have pistons.
Did I not say that?
You
did I
said
not
it.
Say
yeah.
that?
Mike
one
Rogers said it. I heard it.
Absolutely yeah. turned this whole thing.
Oh, he landed right
Parker,
hand by Parker.
Parker is now. Oh, my God.
He's at Parker.
He's
down.
Down.
He's
not going to get up.
He is not going to get up. He is not going to get up. This fight is over. It is over.
He's letting him fight.
Wow,
I
he's
have no
him fight.
Earthly idea. That's a bad idea. That's
wow.
a bad idea. Parker's
wow.
out on his feet. Parker's out on his feet. They need to stop this
oh,
fight.
Oh, God.
G-O.
Stop the fight.
Stop the
what
fight.
Are you doing, referee?
What is going on?
Stop the fight. Stop the fight.
Jesus. Wow.
That should be it. That should be it.
Don't do that.
Let's go. Daniel Bennett. The fighting
you said he had power. You called it,
Music
JT.
City
he said
boxing.
He had power.
Wow.
Wow.
Power
oh,
was
wow.
the absolute. And heart. Yep. Heart.
Power
you
and heart.
That dude.
Power
get Nicholas
and
Parker
heart.
A stool, guys. All right, they got him a stool. Let's get that guy sitting because he's wobbly.
That was
you
an amazing punch.
On multiple occasions, yeah, but
wow.
he's never hit me that hard, thankfully. Wow. I think he takes it easy on me.
Wow. That right there, that's how legends are made.
That's how legends are made.
That's how legends are made.
The honky-tonk hitman.
The honky-tonk hitman on the call.
Man.
I see you, Daniel Bennett. Let's go.
What an incredible bout.
How old is Daniel Bennett?
That's a good question, man. I'd say early 30s.
I think he's between 18 and 40.
Yeah, between 18 and 40. Wow. Wow, what a feeling, huh?
Wow.
You know what
a
looks
feeling.
Like right now?
That's
like,
with headgear
he looks
on,
like
too.
Jeremy Williams.
Yeah, with headgear.
Knocking dudes out with headgear on, bro. That's some serious power.
Jeremy Williams had some big power.
Yes, he did. He fought in Gallatin, Tennessee once. Judged
really?
One of his fights, yeah.
Oh, so you watched a round.
Stevie.
Yeah, it was
Stevie.
One round.
Yeah.
Exactly
you
right.
You watched a round.
Daniel Bennett in the building. Let's go.
That was an incredible
I
bout.
I see you, coach.
Man.
That's funny. The crowd's loving it.
The crowd exploded in that particular
Coach
moment.
Coach Stevie, wow. the owner of Music City Boxing, saying we took the referee out of it because he was frustrated with, I think, some of those pauses, as were we. I'm not sure why we need the scorecards. We could probably wrap this up. But, hey, how about that, Mike Rogers? How about that, David Hudson?
That was awesome.
That was
awesome.
That might be the fight of the night.
Oh, it's got to be.
Got to be.
I mean, I don't know what we have ahead of us. We got some great fights coming up ahead.
Fireworks, baby.
That was absolutely the knockout of the night.
Ooh-wee.
Let me have the.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the winner by referee stops contact test. In the 203-pound division, from Tennessee, Daniel Bennett!
That was serious, huh?
You called that one, JT.
That was serious.
You said that he packs some serious power.
He does,
man.
Well, he's been putting on some muscle, too. He's getting bigger every time I see him, man. The guy's lifting every weight he can find, I think.
He's got muscles in places I don't even have places.
Whoops.
I was on the wrong mic.
You said that into the wrong microphone, but that's all right. Hey, you know what?
I said it into the wrong mic.
Oh, Jesus. Wow.
All right. Moving right along.
Mike David Rogers.
Michael David Rogers.
Leave it to me. I'm doing two jobs here. I'm doing two jobs, and I said it to the wrong way.
Well,
you know,
the crowd seemed to really like it.
Well, you know,
the crowd thought it was funny.
You're
a funny guy. Hey,
he is
what? Tell you what, that's tough for Parker because, I mean, he got really rocked. I mean, he's still – look, you see as he's walking away, he's still wobbly.
Yes, yes.
But Daniel Bennett's got to be feeling like he is on cloud. So now will he fight again tomorrow, or how does that work?
I'm not sure. I have to look at
Okay.
Yeah, you're putting me on the spot.
No, I'm sorry. I just didn't know there's a possibility of that, though.
Yes.
So some of these guys will fight both days. Okay,
absolutely.
That's what I was asking.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I don't want your drink to get spilled here, David Hudson.
Is that mine?
All right, somebody's. Is it not yours? Give it a taste.
I can't believe my draft.
Yeah, you did.
You
spilled right into the mic.
I'm doing two jobs here.
You're doing more than that, really. You're wearing a lot of hats. The cowboy hat.
That's true.
Ring announcer.
That's true.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the 16 and 17-pound junior golden gloves, 156-pound novice division from Louisiana in the red corner, Antonio Zavala! And from Mississippi, in the blue corner, Melvin Smith!
Fights. I don't care what y'all say.
Yeah,
those are great fights, man. We have enjoyed them thoroughly. Now, Melvin Smith IV, it says unattached. Mike, can you explain what that means?
Unattached.
So unattached means that he is not associated to a registered gym in USA Boxing.
Mm. Okay.
Doesn't mean that he's not part of a gym. It just means that he's not part of a gym that's registered with USA Boxing.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
Well, I like the last novice bout.
Heck yeah,
if it's anything close to the last one.
I'm excited, man, because that's the guy who I'm definitely closest friends with on this whole card was Daniel Bennett, and to see him have that kind of success just really resonates.
Oh,
that was a good
nice
right hand,
by
right
Melvin
hand.
Smith IV.
Yeah,
good
Melvin
right hand.
Smith IV.
Well,
I bet all
what.
The Melvin Smiths were tough.
Now,
one, two,
I was
three,
sitting here thinking the
four.
Same thing.
I bet there hasn't been a not tough Melvin Smith. But he's 0-0, huh? Unattached, no record, but he's tough.
They're landing some good shots, too.
Left. Melvin Smith fighting out of that southpaw stance, finding a home for his rear hand.
That's right. You know, I got a boxer boxing tomorrow.
Tell me about it.
Noah Bounds.
Oh, I saw him 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, yeah. He's from Nolensville, Tennessee, 17 years old.
Nolensville.
Yes, yes. Tough kid.
Yeah, I like this guy.
He's a good kid.
Melvin Smith IV. He is. Oh, big power.
Oh, my goodness. Did you see that little 1-2 piece?
Antonio is going to have to keep his hands up, man.
Yes,
he came all the way from Louisiana to eat some shots.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you what, Melvin has got a great little 1-2 piece. Sure.
He sure does. Got some elusiveness to him, too.
Yeah, he's fun.
And he's
like
hard
him.
To hit.
Mm. Yeah. That big word and also hard to hit.
Wow.
David Hudson. Teaching us all a few vocabulary words.
Mike, you have quite a bit of experience training fighters.
Yes.
How much work do these fighters put in?
A lot. See, the irony is,
that was
Melvin
Smith IV.
Melvin Smith IV is making 1, 2, and 3 very proud right now.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3.
Oh, man.
I always think the amount of planning and the amount of everybody's got to be on the same page to get all the way to 4 You know, you got to have boys. You got to have a wife willing to do it, you know, willing to say the name. It can be, the you know, repeated.
Oh, man.
A lot of people got to be on board.
You don't know that they're all in the same family. It could be like George Foreman. He named all his kids George.
That's true.
I mean, Melvin Smith may be the fourth kid named in his family.
That could be. I'd like to meet Trevor Wheeler the fourth.
Right.
Imagine what that kid's going to be like.
Trevor Wheeler the fourth would absolutely
be. In like the year 2100?
I bet he's gorgeous.
Oh, I'm guaranteed.
I guarantee it.
A male model.
Absolutely. We need to.
Trevor Wheeler the first is great.
Can we put a picture, a swimsuit picture up of
Trevor
Wheeler?
Is there any way that we can do that?
Do we have any way that
we can? Being that he's in charge of the production, I'm going to say no.
Absolutely.
If it was
Trevor
possible.
Trevor Wheeler Productions for ITK OnlyFans.
ITK Trevor Wheeler.
Oh, he's putting it up.
Oh, he's looking
it's
for
coming.
It. He's looking for it. Oh, this is going to be nice. Oh, this is going to be so nice.
Trevor.
If we find a picture of Trevor Wheeler, you guys will understand what we're talking about here. Oh, boy.
Boy, right.
We've lost all focus. Let's get back.
Melvin Smith, the fourth, is coming back out, looking to start the action very quickly.
Shout out to our new official in the ring, Miss Charlotte Price, owner of Grindhouse Boxing.
Doing a good job of letting the fighters fight.
Shout out to Matt Young and
Matt Young,
TriStar Boxing.
Matt Young right there.
Oh, goodness.
We're checking out a picture of Matt Young there, along with.
Put it up.
No, let's not. Let's not say we did.
That sounds like he did.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
What makes it difficult to fight a southpaw if you're an orthodox fighter, Mike?
Because you're not left-handed, too.
There it is.
So, no, what makes it difficult is to. So, I want you to look here. To fight a southpaw boxer correctly, he needs to have his left foot always on the outside of Melvin's right foot.
Right, right. Oh, so and he's fighting back now.
He needs to stay out there. Also, another thing that you need to do is you need to throw a lot of right-hand leads. And you need to not try to jab with the jabber, all right? Because you're going to get caught. So, a lot of right-hand leads and staying outside that foot will help you be far more, as a novice, in this particular scenario, will help you be far more productive. But if you look, the majority of the time, the young man is going to the wrong side. He's walking into the power hand. And that's
he's getting tattooed with counterpunch left
you're
hand.
Zavala's going the wrong way. He's staying inside that lead
that's
foot.
Correct.
Got it.
And that's a very novice trademark. But, I mean, these kids are green as graveyard moss. I mean, they're learning their craft, and that's all part of the Golden Gloves as well. You know, that's what this is all about. They're learning their craft.
Well,
I can promise you this. This time next year, both boxers will be completely different boxers.
Let me ask you that. You know, with a pro fighter, you know, you're looking at maybe 2, 3, 4 fights, maybe a year. Amateurs, I mean, they're fighting 15, 20 fights a year, right?
Another round in the bank.
I don't know. I'm asking.
Well, when I was growing up, we could fight every weekend or every other weekend.
Oh, wow.
Because boxing was that popular. The problem is, nowadays, as an amateur is lucky if they can get 10 bouts in a year.
Gotcha. So 10's a good average.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, you had, before you got on the telecast here with us, Hudson was giving a lot of credit to you, man, and your background, your pedigree. Said you had over 200 amateur fights, huh?
Correct.
Wow.
Yep.
Wow. And you were telling me when we were over there at that cool silent auction table that you won the Arkansas Golden Gloves 85, 86, 87, and 88?
Yes, sir.
4 years in a row, huh?
Yes, sir.
Finally, they said, let somebody else have some fun, man. Get out of here. Take yourself somewhere else, man. So what'd you do? Is that when you turned pro in 89?
No, that's when I decided I wanted to be a country music singer. And
How cool is that, man? Yeah. Boxer, country music singer.
Well, I don't know. I'm back in boxing. How cool is it?
Yeah, cool, though. I like that one song you were singing earlier, man. That was a really cool song, actually. You know. I was impressed. All right.
Oh my gosh,
what a left hand. How is he standing? Zavala's got some whiskers on him.
Melvin Smith the fourth may not have an official record, but he has fought.
Yeah, he's fought.
He's fought in the gym.
Well, you know, and didn't you say he came from Mississippi? Was it Pearl, did you say?
Yeah.
Well, Pearl, Mississippi, as I said, is a strong hotbed of boxing down there.
they may not be, you know, they may not have a whole lot of sanction battles.
Right,
have a lot of gym
smokers,
wars.
Smokers, yeah.
A lot of gym wars. Not a smoker would be sanctioned.
Smokers these are sanctioned?
Guys, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You know why they call them smokers?
No, I just said that to be cool.
Because back in the day, they would sanction the events, and everybody would sit around the ring smoking cigars.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they'd have people, girls, selling cigars and stuff, and they called them smokers.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's
Michael
cool.
David Rogers dropping the knowledge.
Yeah, dog. Yeah, dog.
I got to because I can't drop the beat.
Can't drop the beat.
Yep.
Hey, shout out to Billy Blair. He just texted in. Good guy, man. Billy the Boulder, ITK, production stand-up.
That's a good dude, man. That's a darn good dude.
Great guy. Great guy. Oh, hey, how about this kid fighting back?
Oh.
Somebody forgot to tell him the fight was over because Antonio's a
look at him. He's trying. He's going for it.
He's going for it.
He's going for it.
That's fight. Hart. That's Hart right
there. That's Hart. He's a tough kid, man. Well, he came all the way from Louisiana. You know he didn't travel that far just to lay down.
Mouths open. These guys are tired. What'd the hitman say about conditioning?
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Can make a difference. All of a sudden, all that talent that you have, all of that natural athletic ability that you have, the moment you're gassed, you're just another fighter. You're just looking for, you know, the bell to ring. You're just looking for
what a gross
way
feeling,
out.
Right?
And you can and you see it in their face. You see it in their eyes, and you can tell it in the way that they respond. I'm not saying that that's what happened to Melvin.
No,
but
it's
I'm just
general.
Telling you as a fighter's psyche, whenever they run out of gas, they just become human,
what's
regardless
that?
Of how talented they
but
are.
But can we all agree that Blue won
yes,
the fight?
Yes,
I'm not going to agree to anything.
Yeah, I mean, I
well,
would,
that's true.
In my
yeah.
opinion, 2-1 at least, if not 3-0, but – what's that saying that exhaustion makes cowards of men or something like that?
Yes, that and Smith and Wesson.
So, yeah.
I like the respect the two fighters showed each other.
Yeah,
after the fight too.
The sportsmanship's good. Been phenomenal tonight. You know, you haven't had any beef. You haven't had anybody talking junk, you know.
No, just us.
Right. Well, we have.
Yeah.
That's what we're supposed to do.
Absolutely.
But these
absolutely.
Young men have really, really shown a lot of great sportsmanship in all the fights. All right. I'm excited to see. Oh, these guys are only 16 and 17 years old.
16, 17 years. These are kids. These are mere kids.
Wow.
Just think what they're going to be in a year from now.
Yeah.
A year older.
Imagine. Yeah, they are going to be a year older, unquestionably. I would stand by that. Now that. Hey, how about it, boys?
Blue corner.
All right, we'll see.
I'm afraid. David, my
I know he went ballistic two fights ago, yeah, didn't he? Yeah.
It was just terrible.
Why do we even bring it back up?
Really terrible.
Let's not bring it back up.
Okay,
we're getting worked up again.
Yeah.
We finally got him calmed down over here,
yes.
Trevor.
Yeah.
All right. The scores are being tabulated. We shall see. But that was a fun fight.
That was a fun
really,
fight.
Really, really fun fight. There's been a lot of great action, man. Cool dreadlocks in the blue corner on his coach there, man. Those are some unique, kind of, speaking of Derrick Henry, kind of Derrick Henry-esque, right? All right, we have a decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner in the 16 and 17-pound junior golden gloves, 156-pound novice division.
In the blue corner, Melvin Smith.
Love to see the reaction.
Good decision. Good job by the judges. You know, you got to give credit where credit's due.
Absolutely.
They've done a good job on all except one fight.
Which one was that? Oh, never mind. Let's keep David Hudson calm.
This next kid coming up, I'm telling you, this is going to be a really, really good fight.
Talk to me about it.
Casey Hudson is 8-2. And Chris Rudd, and Casey Hudson's from Mississippi, but Chris Rudd Jr., let me tell you what, that kid can box. I've seen him in the National Silver Glove several times.
Family of fighters too, right?
He's 11-4. The kid can absolutely fight. And I'll tell you something else. His dad, Chris Rudd Sr., was a National Silver Gloves champion 5 times.
Wow.
Five times.
So he beat your record.
He's being trained by a very, very good, competent coach.
Ladies and gentlemen. In the 16 and 17-year-old junior 156-pound open division from Mississippi, in the red corner, Casey Hudson. And in the blue corner, representing Tennessee,
Chris Rudd Jr.
This is going to be, I have a sneaky feeling, an action-packed fight.
Oh, I hope.
I think this is going to be exciting.
Now, hey, awesome. If you could, Mike, break down for me a little bit. Trevor actually just asked this question. Our guy Trevor Wheeler,
sure.
Shout out. Silver gloves as opposed to golden gloves.
National Silver Gloves. So I'm actually the president of the National Silver Gloves.
Oh.
And this year we're adding 17-year-olds. It's the first time ever in the history of the tournament, 58 years. And we're going to go from 8 to 17 because Golden Gloves
so goes
from 18 to 40. It's going to be a handshake, a complete handshake, if you will, from the children, the juniors, the youth, all the way up into the Golden Gloves boxers. Up until then,
well, we want to come commentate a Silver Glove.
Yeah.
Well, let's do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Only if Trevor Wheeler comes.
Okay.
Okay.
I don't think we can have him around kids, though.
Oh, that's true because of that whole thing. Yeah.
There's absolutely
500 feet of a school and everything.
Yes. Yes.
Well, maybe maybe another time.
Maybe another time.
Mike, how many fights we have left tonight? Is this the second to last?
This is the second to last.
So this is the co-main event.
This is the co-main event.
This is the penultimate fight.
The penultimate.
Yeah, and it's almost the last one.
Yep. Oh, I see. I see what you did there. Hudson, you know I only have a GED.
You know he's quite pedantic, isn't he?
Yeah, you gotta keep it real.
JT
simple.
Conway is one of my best law students. He's lying, y'all.
What?
Well, man, that's smart. That would make him a great lawyer.
Hey. All right.
I would make all kinds of lawyer jokes, but
now who is this referee?
That is Clay Huddleston.
Clay Huddleston with the solid beard game.
Yes, absolutely.
Checking the gloves. Checking it twice. He's going to find out who's naughty. Oh, that's because I was thinking that he looked like Santa Claus.
I already gave it back to the guy.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
Not mine.
Well, if it is, you're going to have company.
Here we go. Casey Hudson in the red corner against Chris Rudd Jr. in
any
the
relation,
blue corner.
Casey Hudson and
no,
David Hudson. Okay.
No, don't believe so. Casey Hudson, a southpaw, good jab.
Interesting. I'm going to tell you, I'm just going to go out on a limb right now, and I'm going to tell you Casey Hudson is far too loose to be fighting in that particular type of style with a guy like Chris Rudd. Chris Rudd is too compact. I mean, he's a tall fighter, but he's very compact. He doesn't waste energy. He doesn't waste punches. And you come that loose with somebody like Chris Rudd, and he will make you pay.
Okay. Well, he already did with one left hand.
Well, and if you keep your hands down like that, I don't care who you are. It didn't hit. He didn't land.
That hit a glove?
No, it's creative, though.
It was creative.
Very unorthodox.
But you can be creative on the ground, too.
Hey-o.
Yes, you can. Rudd is stalking him.
Yes, absolutely. Like a calculated killer.
Calculated killer. That's cool.
Very methodical. Look how he's walking him down. He's walking him down. I think you're going to see the experience here. I don't know who Casey Hudson went 8-2 with, but I would venture to guess that this is unlike any other person that he's been in the ring with.
He's throwing some really wild looping punches. Gotta straighten those out, Mr. Hudson.
I would agree. I would think with your average bear, they might fall for something like this. Some of this little trickery that he's doing.
Yeah, but not Rudd.
Everybody wants to be Roy Jones Jr. Yeah, until you get punched in the face. You know, it's really.
Speaking of punched in the face,
man. I'm gonna shoot you straight.
All right.
He's using a lot of athleticism and not a lot of boxing skills.
Got
I'm
it.
Talking about
yeah
Hudson.
Yeah.
There's a lot of mechanics that are not quite right there.
Which could serve him well to your point. Maybe through the first round a little bit or the first minute, you know. But as they go through three rounds, I think Rudd is gonna show his superior boxing skill and prowess. Landing a nice jab there.
Yeah, he's controlling the distance. He's landing the bigger shots. And he's not getting hit as much.
Very important.
Very, very, very important.
Got to try to do that as best he can. Now, we're back again tomorrow. So, if folks are tuning in at home, is it $9.99 per day?
Per hour.
$9.99.
No. Per day. We don't charge by the minute.
Gotcha. Classy.
Only when we're showing pictures of Trevor Wheeler.
Then we can charge what you want.
That's the only time by the
minute. The sky's the limit.
Yeah, sky's the limit.
You pay with crypto, Bitcoin.
You know what? If we don't make Trevor Wheeler famous from all this, then we have not done our job.
I mean, we've been getting text messages all night.
I'm telling you, people.
Who is this guy?
People want to know who Trevor Wheeler is. I'm going to talk about he's the big wheeler.
The big wheeler.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. Big wheel, keep on turning.
Proud Mary, keep on burning.
Let's go. Trevor Wheeler.
Rolling on a wheel.
They have not been drinking. I can attest to that.
Hard to believe.
Just natural mirth.
That is true. Yes.
Jocularity.
Yes.
Jocularity.
Euphoria.
Big wheeler. Oh!
Big wheeler, keep on turning.
Solid left hand by your boy Rudd.
I'm telling you.
Could be a little more active, though.
Yeah, I like to see him establish his dominance because he's clearly the better fighter.
We're going to have to call him, we're going to have to give him the nickname, the Stud.
Stud Rudd?
Yeah, the Stud Rudd.
Big Wheeler, Stud Rudd. We got some good nicknames coming in.
Ooh, he's from the Covington Boxing Club. Have there been a lot of good amateurs out of Covington, Tennessee?
Oh, my goodness, yes.
Absolutely. Where is Covington?
Relative close to Memphis, isn't it?
Oh, okay.
It is. Well, and it's out of that Jackson area.
Jackson,
too.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Man, there's so much talent. The Obi Beard, Jackie Beard, Aubrey Beard. You had, there's just so much talent.
Was your fighter Paris Jackson from that area? Didn't you have a fighter?
No, Paris McCullough.
Paris McCullough.
And you know, Paris McCullough beat,
good fighter.
He beat Caleb Plant.
He was an excellent fighter.
Marcus Brown. He beat a lot of guys that ended up becoming
world champions. One of the toughest fights I ever judged in the amateurs was Paris and Caleb.
Oh, really?
Both you so judge quick. That?
I judged that. It was so close.
Who'd you give it to?
Gave it to Caleb, but it was
and
competitive.
Caleb won it. And Caleb won it.
It was competitive.
Yeah, Caleb won it.
It was a round where the first two rounds were pretty even, and then Caleb distinguished himself in the third round.
Caleb was just a different breed, man. I'm telling you, you knew Caleb was going to be special even as a young. Oh, absolutely. You knew he was going to be special.
Hand speed.
Everything. He was technically sound. He was disciplined. He was just an outstanding boxer. I remember seeing Jermaine Taylor like that, and I looked at my dad and I said, you know what? This kid will not only go to the Olympics, he'll be a world champion. And he did it.
I'm not
Nostradamus, but I called that one.
Hey,
Jermaine Taylor.
Guy.
Holds two victories over the great Bernard Hopkins.
The only man to do that.
Wow.
Where is Jermaine Taylor now?
Arkansas.
Still in Arkansas. Okay.
What time is he? He could probably sleep.
A great fighter.
Yes, absolutely.
And your father was his cut man, correct?
He was for his entire career.
Wow.
As a matter of fact, the fight that with Tim Zhu the other day, Jermaine had the same cut in the same location when he fought Bernard Hopkins the first time, and it happened after the second or third round. Roy Jones Jr. made the statement and said, that cut right there is going to be a big problem for Jermaine and could change the outcome of this fight. After that round, my daddy got a hold of it, and he came back out, and it was never spoke of again. That's the difference between having a top-notch cut man and having one that probably
And you yourself are a top-notch cut man.
I am.
You
I
should
am.
Be getting more cut man action than you get.
Well,
you're
you know
awesome at it.
There's a lot of good cut men in the state of Tennessee. I would say I'm up there in the top three. I mean, you got to put Billy Blay up there. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I would say I'm in the top three for sure.
What can Casey Hudson do here?
Well, I would say he probably needs to.
I mean, he doesn't have the power to stop Rudd. I mean, I guess just survive?
No, not survive. That's not – he needs to keep his hands up, and he needs to
– Oh, he ate a big shot there.
What he's trying to do, he's trying to get these like –
Yeah, like weird looping uppercut.
Yeah, yeah. And he doesn't have the power. He doesn't have the power to
do that. Yeah. He's just not – oh, that's –
He's not a seam of men.
Kind of a guillotine choke there he put on our boy Rudd.
But I will say this. He's game. He's very,
very game.
Yeah.
Very willing.
He's everybody, very willing.
Everybody on tonight's card has been, man. I mean, there hasn't been anybody who's taken a backward step. There have been a lot of great fighters.
And let me make this one statement about Casey Hudson. If Casey Hudson will develop his actual and work on his actual the fundamentals, if Casey Hudson will work on his fundamentals and the mechanics of how he actually boxes, he could be a very good boxer.
He has some good athleticism, doesn't he?
He's got some fantastic athleticism, but his mechanics are all wrong, and they need to go back to the board. They need to work it all out because it's not right.
I like how Rudd fights in the clinch. Really, really gets some good power. Oh, don't turn your back, though. Don't turn your back. That's a bad. Oh, that's bad, bad, bad body language to show the judge. Oh. Wait, did he just get.
Referee has a very unique refereeing style.
What's he doing? Did he have to have gotten knocked down. I mean, he's still down.
No, it's from gas.
Exhaustion.
I think that's a blue corner.
I don't believe so, but good boy.
He's just gassed.
Now, is there a reason why Liso and Cook is the last fight?
Yeah, how do you decide that, Mike?
Let me look.
I like Chris Liso, man.
It's a championship fight for the 165-pound novice division.
Oh.
Excellent.
So whoever wins this goes to Detroit.
No, this is novice. Only open.
Got it.
So do they get a trophy?
They
get a trophy, but, you know.
Now, do you get participation trophies or only the winner gets a trophy?
What are we talking about? Get out of here.
No.
Participation trophy. Hey.
What does that even mean? What does that even mean?
It means everybody gets a trophy.
Not literally.
Not everybody wins.
Hey, I tell you what, this next kid, though, coming out, Chris Liso, watch out. Trust me. Kind of like the way that Daniel Bennett had some power, so does Chris Liso.
Excellent. Yeah, have you sparred with him as well?
No, I'd be scared to, man. I mean, he's dangerous. All right. This should be a pretty clear-cut decision. I think we can go ahead and call this.
I bid on one of those jackets, Mike. I want one of those.
Yeah.
You already got outbid.
Oh, yeah.
On both of them?
On both of them.
No.
Yeah.
Really?
Do I got time to go down there?
Well, it's
over tomorrow.
Oh, the guy told me it was tonight.
No, it's over tomorrow.
So if you tell me, I'll put a bid in for you tomorrow.
All right.
Judge is taking a.
It shouldn't take
long
this long.
Long time with a decision that seems pretty clear.
It's for the drama.
For the build up the drama.
That's right.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner in the 16 and 17 pound, 156 pound junior golden gloves open division, in the blue corner, Chris Rudd Jr.
I can't believe I said it. He got muscles in places I didn't even
know. Yeah, right into the microphone.
Right into the microphone. Man.
All right, it's main event time, boys. Oh yeah, so Mike, I don't think you answered this. How do you determine who boxes where? Like, how did you pick this to be the main event? Did you say it because it was a championship?
Yeah, you did say it.
Okay, the rest of them are just kind of arbitrarily picked.
No, the computer does it.
Ah.
Whenever the bracket is drawn, the computer we use
decides
Conker Club,
the
and it decides the order. Of the
interesting.
Bracket.
Okay. There's Chris Liso entering the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event. Please remember, boxing starts at 1 p.m. tomorrow. If you are boxing tomorrow, remember the physicals are 10. I mean, the weigh-ins are 10 to 12 a.m. Physicals start at 11 a.m. Bouts start at 1 p.m. Also, remember that you can stream this bout anywhere all over the country. You can stream the finals of this Mid-South Golden Gloves at TKO Picks, Ticks.
What?
Trevor.com.
What?
Ladies and gentlemen.
Trevor Wheeler.
The 18-14, 165-pound male novice division. In the red corner, from Tennessee, Christopher Liso. And in the blue corner, from Mississippi, ladies and gentlemen, Arkansas. Somebody gave me some bad information up here, and I'm sorry about that. From Arkansas, representing Arkansas, somebody make some noise for Arkansas. Brighton Cook.
All right. Crowd, quick to let you know, this gentleman is from Arkansas.
The guy that was creating my data for me didn't tell me.
Crowd turned on you quick, man.
Quick.
Tell you what. What else does this guy have to do for you people?
Oh, yeah, we don't have a number on him.
2-0, Chris Liso, 2-3. But now, look, I don't know to be, you know, fair, the first thing about Mr. Cook, Brighton Cook.
It's 2-0.
But I do know that, other
I'll
than that.
I'll tell you this, though. Let me just tell you
tell
this.
Me, tell
He's
me.
Coming from straight right out of Little Rock, Arkansas. And
tell me about
those
that.
Those guys, they work out for like a year before they ever even have their first bout. So,
really?
Yeah.
So he's going to be ready.
Could be. Could be.
Now, I've seen Chris Liso.
I have too. He's a
bunch.
Very fluid,
I
very
like
good
him.
Fighter. He's a very
great
good
body
fighter.
Shots. He throws some fierce body shots.
He's very good technically. Too.
Yep. Yeah.
So I'm just saying, this could be a whole lot more competitive fight than the records say.
So are you giving a fighter of the night tonight or no?
No.
Okay. Because if you did, probably that Daniel Bennett, huh?
No,
with the knockout.
Trevor
Wheeler. 18 Wheeler.
Fighter of the night.
Fighter of the night.
Trevor
he's,
Big
Wheeler. He's fought through all the garbage we've thrown at him. Here we go.
Oh, I'm serious. Come
I'm excited.
On.
I'm excited for this.
Two southpaws.
Absolutely.
That's exciting.
About as rare as it gets.
Good jab there from the red corner. Chris Liso.
Both of these are very quick technical boxers. I'm going to be honest with you. Both of these guys
twitchy.
Already look like they've had more bounce than what they
twitchy. Yeah,
say.
They are. They do. You're right.
He's not closing the gap. Liso needs to really.
Yeah, Cook's landing some good body shots.
And Liso's not closing the gap. He really needs to. He needs to jab until he lands and then start the combination.
That's interesting. Yeah, that's good. Good. Oh, there's a nice one.
That was a good.
What?
I don't.
Wait, why?
I don't know. I didn't.
Why, Mike?
Boy, another more crap officiating.
I didn't agree with that.
Jesus, it's a bad call.
I mean, how you get a standing eight count for just getting hit?
I mean, Jesus.
He didn't even.
I didn't agree with it.
Okay. Well, moving on.
Who put that guy in the ring?
Hey, come on.
Jesus.
Who's running this thing?
You know what? We're not in there. We didn't see what he saw. So
Yes, we did. All three of us did.
No, we didn't. We're not looking into the eyes of the boxer. He might have saw something that we didn't see. You have to give him.
He does have those rec specs on.
Yeah, he does have big, thick glasses.
You know.
What happened? Oh, shoot. Had a little bit of a equipment malfunction. Got an. Great camera work there by Trevor, 18 Wheeler, zooming in.
18 Wheeler.
Got to give credit to Billy Blay on that one. Let me know. That's the way to go. 18 Wheeler, here we go. And we're back. The action is live and it is hot. Chris Liso, big backhand.
Land a jab and get a standing eight count. Yes. Yay.
Oh, nice shots there from both fighters.
Great round. I like this fight. I like both these fighters. Mike's right. Good fighters.
These are. You know, I just kind of had an instinct. When you see straight right coming out of Little Rock, those kids have they've spent a lot of time in the gym preparing for their first bout. So
when you see one or two bouts, you might, oh, this guy's green. Well, you got to take into consideration where he's coming from. I kind of take that same approach. I don't allow a kid to get into the ring for a long time. One of the old ideas is that you know, you get them into the ring as quickly as possible. You try to have as many bouts as possible. I don't agree with that. I'm a little different. Don't let them
learn in the ring. Don't let them learn on the fly.
Absolutely.
Let them learn with coaching in a controlled environment.
Absolutely. I think both of them have, you know, a lot more experience than what their records state.
When you say that a boxer is fluid, Mike, can you describe to the audience what you mean by that?
Absolutely. So when you say wait a minute, Liso just got hurt. Did you see that?
Yeah.
No.
Great right
Liso
hand.
Liso took a really good. Oh.
No, please don't count. Please don't count.
I don't know why Liso didn't get a
right.
count.
Well,
right.
that's where you want the ref to be equitable, right?
I understand, but to your point though, if you're gonna be equitable to that point,
that should have been a thing, anything, right? Yeah.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, don't be one sided, ref.
Oh, nice work by Liso, man. Tell you what, both these guys look sharp. They're fast. They're quick twitch guys.
I think Liso's having a struggling a little bit here.
Oh,
yeah, he's getting hit.
I think he's a little baffled. I think
he fights back in.
It was.
But now he's getting caught with that second and third jab.
Definitely. So.
Oh, big right hand.
Nice shot.
But it goes back to what I said. What did he need to do? Jab until he lands,
yep,
then
jab,
throws his combination.
Jab until he lands.
That's exactly what's starting to happen, and he's closing that gap.
I'm going
to
remember that for a long time. Jab until you land, and then start your combination.
Yes.
Nice quick jab by Liso.
If you don't land that left hand, there's no point in throwing any other.
Good point. Oh, beautiful.
Nice jab.
Beautiful
so.
Jab. Oh!
Oh,
beautiful. He slipped it down.
Wow.
Music City Boxing stand
beautiful
up.
Shot.
That was an absolute banger of a shot.
Banger. Absolutely. And no one can quibble with that standing.
No, not at all.
Excellent.
Not
excellent.
At all.
Well,
and I'm going to tell you, how much it hurt him. The
Mr.
Fact,
Cook
the,
might
the,
need a KO to
well,
win this fight.
Well, the fact that he actually acknowledged the shot
yeah.
and then tapped gloves basically to say, yeah, you got
you
me.
You got
yeah.
me.
You got me.
Good sportsmanship again.
So there is absolutely zero chance that Cook can win this bout unless he stops Liso in this last round. Now, I will say this. If Cook doesn't come out like the barn's on fire, like the baby's for sale, like he needs to absolutely stop this
wow.
guy, he's going to lose this fight. He's
yeah.
going to lose this
yeah,
fight.
I agree.
Or if the
barn's
for sale,
emergency.
What if the barn's for sale and the baby's on fire?
Then you're in.
That's
trouble.
Even worse.
Well, it's worse.
Lord.
That means you didn't get out of the barn in time.
Yeah, that poor baby.
Yes. Throw it out with the bathwater.
Ew. Here we go. This is going to be a fun third round, man, because he knows he's got to win this round big.
Yeah.
He's got to win it convincingly.
He's got to stop him.
He's got to stop him.
Yeah, stop him.
And he's got to fight like he's got to stop him.
Yeah. Mm. And Liso's going to be brimming with confidence after that big knockdown.
You know what?
I'm glad he got that knockdown, because if things would have turned on that awkward standing eight in the beginning, that would have been a real shame. But
for him to establish,
another big shot.
Hey, I told you guys, man, this kid is nice.
Oh, my goodness.
This Liso kid is nice.
We're going to have to call him the Mona Liso.
Oh, Mona. I love it.
Because this kid is an absolute...
He's a work of art.
He's a work of art. He is the Mona Lisa.
Oh, he ate a nice Nice rear right.
Yeah, but Liso has a very good chin.
Yeah.
He's taking some clean shots and not even moved.
As you were just saying that, he ate two.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the difference is, though, is conditioning here. He's in a lot better shape, and his punches still have the same steam that he had on him in the first round, whereas Cook doesn't.
This is one of my favorite rounds
the reason,
of the night.
The reason these punches are hurting Cook far more is because his gas tank
is
empty.
Yeah, yeah.
So everything that's hitting him is causing that much more damage.
Well said. Another great left hand by Liso.
Liso could actually stop him here.
Yeah, and it looks like he
wants to
really
too.
Going for it, yeah. He's not resting back knowing that he won those first two rounds convincingly. He's going for the finish. The Music City Boxing guys are tough, man. I'd like to see Liso take a few less shots, right? I mean, as he gets in there with more and more
yeah, he's had six bouts. Yeah, I agree. He's had six bouts. But here's the thing. I think with the experience, he's just going to get better and better.
Oh, no question. And that
excellent
was a great
fight.
You know what? We got to give it to Cook. Cook took some bombs.
Yep.
Yeah,
Cook
kept fighting.
Both guys.
Your average bear would have quit.
Absolutely.
And I don't even mean quit, like just quit the fight.
No,
I mean, they would have quit
giving
trying
up
to win.
On themselves. Yep.
They would have just quit trying to win. They would have been. They'd gone
just trying
this
to survive.
Self-preservation,
survival
protective
mode,
position. And he didn't do that.
Yep.
He continued to go forward. He continued to try to win, and he continued to eat shots.
Tell
but that's
you
not.
What.
He's a tough kid.
I'd like to have seen about three more rounds of that, huh? That was
I'd like to see more fights, Mike Rogers. This has been excellent.
Well, then
come
back
tomorrow. Come
tomorrow.
Don't shoot pool.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll be starting this tomorrow, the finals of the Big
People need to come out. Come watch this.
Absolutely.
This is awesome.
And the doctor's going to be here. He's staying the night, right?
Yeah.
That's his hotel
room
key we found, right?
That was
really?
Yes.
You're kidding.
No. It was not.
I was going to say. Let's make sure he's got a hotel.
No, he's good.
We need him to stay around.
We do.
Well, that was fun. Tell you what, boys, it's been a real pleasure working with you guys.
Oh, I loved it.
And
man,
what
it
a fun way
to
end with those fights. The first half of the night was great. The second half of the night was great.
I tell you, JT, you were very prescient in your assessments of Daniel Bass.
Daniel Bennett.
Yeah. And Christopher Liso. Very prescient.
Tough guys, man.
Daniel Bennett, that's right.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Chris Liso.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner in the 18-40, 165-pound male novice division.
In the red corner, Christopher Liso. Good night, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow,
ladies
1 p.m. You can also stream these bouts. TikTok. Where is it?
I think it's on TikTok.
TKO picks. TKO.
Oh, boy. What? Oh, we better get off the air.
Get us out of here.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a great time. Mike Rogers, David Hudson.
BFCC is coming.
Woo! Love you, boys. See you tomorrow.
What is it, really?